There we go. What's up, everybody? Sorry for the delay. We had we're working some audio issues, and if you guys once we get talking, let me know if you need Shanghai's volume. But today I'm here with Todd Shanghai Sheehy, who is A-10 pilot. I hope I got that right this time. And he's known for his Desert Storm air-to-air kill, but we're going to talk about his career and how he became a fighter pilot and all the cool stuff he's done in his career. So, Shanghai, thank you for showing up on the channel. I appreciate you coming on to tell your story.
Hey, I'm super honored, Mover. It's great to be with you and love your program. So
awesome.
And I have an interesting story, maybe one of the more unique A-10 stories and maybe one of the more unique fighter pilot stories, because I did not set out to be a fighter pilot. I'm not one of those guys that from a little boy wanted to be a pilot. I have no family in the military, but I was interested in aviation actually as a business tool. I was getting an undergraduate degree at a private Christian university here in Oklahoma City in economics and business administration and with a pre-law emphasis. So planning to go to law school and be another shyster lawyer.
Me too. law. Yeah.
So I really wanted to be a trial lawyer. And after an expensive private undergraduate experience, I was trying to figure out how to pay for law school. And, as you know about law school, it's not really something that you can do part-time and work. I worked full-time during college. But somewhere in there, I found time to get a private pilot's license. So here I'm a private pilot about a year before graduating college and figuring about trying to figure out law school. And I worked at a sporting goods store as a department manager at a mall out of the edge of town. And there was an Air Force recruiting office just near there. And one day I just peeled in. And like millions of young men and now women, every year I went in and said, so I'm kind of interested in maybe being a pilot and a lawyer,
Jack, they made a show about it.
Right, exactly. So like a lot of the folks that follow you, young people that are just not really sure about how to go about it. I went about it in an unconventional way also, just kind of just investigating things. And I'm sure the recruiting guy looked at me and rolled his eyes but he called me a couple of days later and he said, hey, you're actually maybe qualified to do this, but I need you to go talk to the officer recruiter at the University of Oklahoma. And so I did that. But it was the whole go to our OTS in the summertime, mm-hmm. and then we'll go, you'll get you in a unit and we'll kind of see, be like, and then we'll send you to law school, but before that, navigator school. So C-130 navigator.
Oh, no.
So I went on a little C-130 trip and I'm not to sit behind the guys sideways and tell them, what radio frequency
yeah.
is. This is not the thing. And so I just sort of put it out of my mind. And then, but along the way, I did all the aptitude testing and the physical testing and, the interviews and all that stuff. And lo and behold, that OU recruiter called me back and he said, hey, I'd like you to come talk to me again. Have you considered just being a pilot in the Air Force? Why law school? We got a lot of lawyers, what's your thing about the law? You're obviously interested in aviation. You've got a private pilot's license. You could go to officers training school and right on to pilot training. And because you don't have a technical degree, a business degree, it's kind of like pilot training, graduation, or probably nothing, Now they didn't really tell me about missile, minor.
none of the other stuff.
Probably would have been. So they arranged for me and two other guys who they kind of thought were good prospects to go up to Enid, Oklahoma, to Vance Air Force Base, which is about an hour and a half from here, pilot training base. And just check it out. We spent 2 days there. We got to, fly to Sims and look at the jets. And I think we got to do the taxi thing like the wives do in pilot training.
really? Yeah, wait, what year is this? What year are we talking?
This would have been 1985.
Oh, wow. Okay.
85 in the beginning of 86.
White jets.
I graduated in 86. Yeah. And so, and at that point, I got pretty interested in it. It's cool, obviously, that the guys were super motivated and great guys, and the IPs were awesome. And so I said to one of the IPs, I said, man, I think I might want to do this and come right here to Vance for pilot training. He's like, no, you don't want to come to Vance for pilot training. If you go to OTS, you want to go to Shepherd for pilot training.
Yeah.
He said, they won't tell you guys about Shepherd until the last couple weeks of OTS. But I'm telling you about it now. They'll pick maybe one or two guys from the 40 or so pilot candidates in an OTS class to go to the Euro-NATO Joint Jet Pilot Training Program at Shepherd with all the NATO fighter pilot candidates, where we used to train the Iranians, you know, and where there's great flying weather and you get 80 more hours in the T-38 than normal UPT at the time. And then, of course, we did not have IFF. We went to lift. That was at Holloman flying the AT-38. And in fact, that picture that I sent you that you had on the intro of me leaning on the AT-38 a couple years ago, that one is actually right across the main gate at Tinker Air Force Base here in Oklahoma City, in a little park in Midwest City, Oklahoma.
Really?
It's sitting right there off of I-40. And I checked the serial number one day, stopped, and I flew that same one three times at lift, including
That's
the
awesome.
Only ride I busted at lift, which was me, an A-10 guy, right? And if you'll recall, we did maybe four or five air-to-air rides and the rest air-to-ground and low-level, right? Well, I'm paired against an F-15 guy. So he's got like 36 air-to-air rides. I got like five, right? And so the token A-10, great for this guy who's already had, you know, maybe 20 air-to-air sorties. And so he's got a German, a major in his backseat, and I got an American guy in my backseat. In fact, it was Rico Rodriguez, Chico. He got what, three air kills in Desert Storm. He is my IP in the back of the state.
Oh,
and
crap.
Great guy, right? And so, super air guy, and he's got this A-10, you know, dweeb in there. And so here we are at the merge, and I got 20/10 vision. So I see the guy a little, you know, just as you know, it goes from a speck to past you in a heartbeat. But I see him, and I get maybe, you know, 15 degrees on him. And so he goes straight up, full burner. Here we go for about, you know, 20,000. We top out about 42 or something, you know. We're up there shaking the tail. I don't know what Rico did. I think he did something that was probably a prohibited maneuver. The team.
Illegal.
Forward sticking opposite rudder. And so my airplane just kind of hung there. And then, it kind of just swapped ends. Well, the other guy's airplane is just kind of trickling downhill, you know, like the T-38 does. You've flown it recently. I know him. Does that tail slide, then kind of falls off. And so now I don't have like nose tail separation, but I got a good 3.9 separation on him. I'm thinking, yes, we're still in full blower, right? Now we're going straight, rolling scissors downhill.
Oh, nice.
And so, you know, fangs through the floor. We're just trying to kill each other. I got a little separation here. I'm trying to get some more angles on him. And it's going to be a stalemate, but I didn't tell you that the first one, I somehow eked out a victory in the first, nice. First engagement. So here we're at engagement number two. It's going to be a stalemate, but except for the fact that all of a sudden my aircraft starts buffeting. Check the speed brake switch.
Oh,
the boards are out.
Structure nice.
Or don't. And then all of a sudden the stick is shaken. You know, so like 2 seconds from buffeting, boards are out, stick shaken. Your jet. And as you know, they don't talk to you the rest of the. He does not talk to you the whole rest of the flight. He flies at home. They do a you know, one to full stop. They get in the van and leave you there. They'll send the van back for you. They don't even want to ride.
They leave you there.
They'll see you in the debrief. Not a word has been said. You've obviously busted the ride. And so both of us went through the mock, downhill full blower, rolling scissors over the white sands. And busted the ride for that.
Wow.
But
well, what
cool.
a story, though.
Yes, that is that airplane, the one that I flew unauthorized supersonic in. And the debrief was about 2.5 hours. It's brutal. And the thing is, of course, back then, we're listening to an audio tape and looking at like a VTR film of the rudimentary gun sight on that thing. And neither of us heard our instructors. My guy's like, airspeed, watch your airspeed, Sheehy airspeed, boards. I got the jet, fuck, you know. then on his jet, the German is screaming, "What's your airspeed?" He's beating on the canopy, and so we heard none of that because we were just so focused on winning that game.
Yeah.
But anyway, a brief sidebar about that little AT-38 sitting out there. So I had a big decision to make. Obviously, am I going to follow my career path of law school, and aviation would be a tool for law, go do brief, you know, go take a deposition or something like that. Great sit time saver. And you know, I was hoping to bill a lot of out, you know, big hourly rate. And so being in general aviation would be a good thing. And so, but because I knew that I was maybe thinking about, you know, military aviation as a stepping stone, which it really isn't, as we know.
No.
It's not a stepping stone to the airlines. It's not a stepping stone to law school or anything else. It's taking a sip out of a fire hydrant, you know, every day. And so you got to be committed to that. And I knew that because I'd gotten an opportunity to talk to these guys who were experiencing pilot training and had gone to OTS and that kind of stuff. And so I kind of knew, you know, kind of we had kind of had the skinny on what was going on and the gouges, I think we used to say, and for the test. And so it's a big decision, really. You know, am I disciplined enough? Yeah. But is this what I want for my life? But it was a time when Ronald Reagan was president. He was building the military back up. Mm-hmm. So we could fight those two theaters. And of course, we still had the Cold War raging. So, you know, the evil commie empire. And so my thought was really somewhat along the lines of, we're going to fight those guys. I mean, I thought that the Cold War was not going to stay cold, that this thing is going to break open. We're going to have World War III. And I thought, you know, I want to be trained to do something useful and not deferment because I'm in college. Or draft or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. And so that was kind of my mindset. And obviously it didn't come to fruition at all. In fact, it was kind of another interesting twist on my career a little bit later, but of course, you know, much to the chagrin of my mother, I kind of about the start of my senior year of college, pretty well resolved that this is what I'm going to do. So that gave me you know, 9 months or so to prepare physically. I was in good shape. I was a competitive swimmer and water polo player in school. I played tennis in college and stuff. But you know, swimmers don't run. So different muscle groups. And so that mile and a half run was a concern of mine. I was in good physical shape and all. But I went out running every morning at the local park just to get, you know, not just to get in shape to finish that mile and a half run, but to excel at that mile and a half run. I wanted to be the fastest guy in the class, you know. Turns out we had an NCAA sprinter in our class.
Oh, God.
So I was not the fastest guy in the class.
Maybe second fastest.
No, man is up there among the top few. And so, but that's the kind of commitment that it takes. Then I had the gouge on NGEP. So when I got to OTS, my focus was do as best as I can. And I knew that there's a point 6 weeks in where you kind of get picked for or get the opportunity to apply for upper class positions. So I was actually put in for wing commander of the school and the class. But there was also another job, deputy wing commander for flying operations.
Nice.
Yeah, this is the thing. Because now one of the guys that was at Vance had been in this job at OTS. And so he said, this is what you want to do, because that guy, the guy that's overseeing you, is a lieutenant colonel fighter pilot.
Yeah.
And the position is take care of the guys that are going through the flight screening program. They're called fish pots, flight screening for officer training students.
Oh, wow.
Candidates, fish pots. Yeah. They actually went to, so they lived at what we call Medina Base. It was an annex of Lackland down there where OTS is. They lived there. So we had our own floor of the dormitory, and they wore green bags. So they were really super cool. Green bags and cool glasses, and they ate chow and they got to talk and, you know, cut up, and we didn't. And then they got on a bus and they went down to Hondo Field in the south of there. And they essentially did a private pilot course syllabus in about 3 or 4 weeks. And it was so high washout.
That's a fire hose.
Yeah, no kidding. Flying Cessna 172s every day in that hot weather. It's just summertime. And the attrition rate was high. And so you'd see these guys come back, and some of them looked, you know, pretty beat up. Some of them were really dejected. Yeah. And the others were just happy to survive one more day. But I thought, so this was a cool thing, because first of all, you were like the top in the top three of the school. So that came with some privileges. Secondly, you were sort of separate from all the rest of the fray, because you were with these guys who wanted to be pilots. I wanted to be a pilot too. So it's really, you know, kind of a cool thing.
Yeah. And so, these are my people.
Yeah. So I went to the interview with the colonel for that, and he offered me the job. And I said, well, sir, tomorrow I've got the interview for the wing commander. And he said a few choice words. And said, well, you know, I think I've made a bad choice in you. I thought you were my guy. Ooh. I thought you want to be a fighter pilot. But you want to go to the shoot clerk interview tomorrow. Why don't you go ahead and do that? And so this is my first foray into the reverse psychology of that thing. That he didn't want me to go do that at all. He wanted me to take the job that he just offered me because it was the best job on campus. And in the extra stripe that the wing commander got, what he wasn't going to be a fighter pilot, probably. Yeah. And he wasn't. In fact, he was a sheep. And so I think the first one was. And they were great. But so I took that job at OTS, graduated with honors at OTS. I won the Daniel Webster Award, which is the public speaking award.
Oh, cool.
Today's challenge, tomorrow's success was my 8-minute speech. And I probably That's practiced awesome. That thing 50 times up on that stage before the competition. It was pretty well a shoe-in that if there was anybody going to NGEP, it would be me. And it was me and one other guy. And so so that's when things started really falling into place because I worked hard. I was not the sharpest tool in the shed by any means. When you get to pilot training, especially NGEP, and you see these European guys who from, you know, little kids have been groomed for this. They are the brightest and best in their country. And their education system is way beyond ours. They speak three or four languages, you know, they've had a lot of indoctrination into small aircraft and gliders and things, kind of like the guys and gals at the academy. But then you got academy people, maybe in your class too, and ROTC people like Mover, and you know who've had a lot more military indoctrination than you've had. You're a 90-day wonder, butter bar, and you're with the brightest and best there is, not only you know in the country, but in the Air Force. I mean, as you know, that there's a very evil but necessary pecking order and ladder and the tip of the spear is very sharp, it's very small, and everything else is very necessary, but the competition is very, very fierce, and you really don't have a tremendous amount of control on it. Frankly, right. I mean, you can only just do your very best. And you know, let things happen the way they're going to happen.
Absolutely.
And make the best of whatever opportunity you have, because there's, you know, flying anything's better than most things, right? You know.
Yeah. No. Absolutely. Yeah.
And in my day, we all wanted F-16s, of course. You know, as it's on a recruiting poster.
As it should be.
Whatever. Lawn dart.
Well, you know, Iron Eagle. I mean, was Iron Eagle out by then?
Iron Eagle was out. Yes, it was out. I did watch Mr. Master, Young Mr. Master. I thought it was cool. And I'll tell you what. And actually, here's an interesting story. I am divorced now, but amicably with a wonderful woman and two great kids that are grown. In fact, my son just graduated from University of Oklahoma Law School.
And
had a job with the world's largest law firm down in Houston, just started a few weeks ago. He's a superstar. My daughter, who is 6'1". Supermodel beautiful. She's very accomplished as well, and there's great young people. So I'm blessed with that. But for 24 years I was married, and I met her the last semester of my senior year in college. We'd gone to the same college, it's not that big, but I worked full time. I didn't live on campus, and she was that lovely young woman that came in late for class if she showed up. And she was dressed to the nines, her coffee. And she worked at the mall as well. She was a Clinique counter manager at a department store. And I was the department manager of a big sporting goods store. And we had lunch a couple times. And she'd ask me what happened in class because she was like down in Dallas shopping or something. And then she asked me out actually a week after graduation.
Oh.
She put a note on my car asking me to play tennis. And so we went and played tennis. And the second date, I took her flying.
Nice.
The airport. What, the little airport over here? Why? Oh, I'm going to go flying. Mm-hmm. So I had a picnic all packed in my mind. Went out to the tall prairie grass out in northwest Oklahoma and, you know, greased one on a little strip out there and had a nice picnic. Pretty impressive. Third date, big boy date. We went to an Italian restaurant and then we went to see Top Gun, baby.
Yeah.
Yes. It just come out. In the theaters, and you're gonna go do that. I play some beach volleyball.
Good for you. Good for you. Yeah. At least you didn't take her to Iron Eagle. So good job on that.
Yeah, that's right. Top gun. And so anyway, we were married halfway through pilot training, which is another adventure in and of itself. And pilot training is very difficult.
Yeah.
And probably not the place to get married either. She's super awesome and was a great partner in the Air Force. And in 8 years we moved 7 times. And we saw a lot of the world, made a lot of great friends. It was just an awesome experience. And but we didn't have the little kids yet. We had kids after the Air Force. And it's a great life, but there's a lot of sacrifice as well. We figured we spent only about half of that time together.
I believe it.
The other time was TV wives and those kind of things. And then 6 months in the desert. And that was really tough on the wives. We were a squadron out of England. And so they didn't have the support system of their parents and friends and things there. You had about 40 wives gathered in somebody's house on base, watching, Bernie Sanders on the hotel, the roof of the Al Rashid Hotel, saying the skies over Baghdad are illuminated tonight, and they're watching that, and knowing that we're going to be flying into harm's way. And because we were from England, we didn't have those AT&T phones that we could call home.
Yeah.
It was about a week before we even, could contact them, unless you were like me, the chief of combat plans, and had a Stu-3 to base ops. And
nice.
Connected to
I did that. I did that in Iraq too. You had to call base ops or the DSN, and
I'd call base ops and have them connect me to my home base very late at night. When there wasn't a lot of traffic on the thing, but very different times, of course. I mean, I can't even imagine really these guys that have to go out and fly combat and then FaceTime with their families and text them and all that stuff. I guess they figure it out, but what the hell would you say? What'd you do today? I talked to my wife, Angela, one time after a mission. It was maybe about my 10th or so mission. And it was really awkward because it just, and she knew what's up. But still, it's a scary thing. And you don't want to minimize it, but you don't want to scare them more either. And if you go 50 miles in Iraq and blew up a bunch of stuff and got shot at a lot, and it was scary. Well, how are you doing? And so so really that we were gone 6 months, but the war is only 42 days, and we got there about 3 weeks before it started. But anyway, I'm kind of jumping ahead, but pilot training was awesome. I won an F-16 and I got an A-10. Now, A-10 was cool. And frankly, no offense to anybody, but the coolest instructor pilots in pilot training were the A-10 guys.
Yeah, always. A-10 dudes are the coolest.
And guess who my primary instructor was in T-38? So I did quite well in T-37s. Of course, Shepherded fighters are nothing. So you fly the T-37, there's no simulators there.
Oh, wow.
There probably is now. And we got 80 more hours in the T-38 than a typical UPT experience. God,
really?
So we did a lot more like four-ship formation and low-level stuff and things. And then went on to lift, but which I guess is now integrated as IFF or whatever. But if they need any instructors. This T-37s, forgiving airplane, cool airplane, is neat to fly a T-37. I mean, it's a sled and it was hot, but it spun well, especially on solo flight. But then the T-38, where as you I saw you take your first flight in the T-38, things haven't passed. So, I mean, you flew the Viper and all, but you got to get that gear up quick because you're gonna rip the doors off if you don't.
Yeah,
it is cool, but it was a lot. And frankly, this guy was behind the jet for a while, and it was a struggle. T-38s was, I was thinking, maybe I'm not cut out for this because
really?
Some of the guys were moving faster than me, and I was struggling a little bit. So they gave me an F-15 guy, Don Canova, call sign Obi-Wan. Obi-Wan Canova.
Clever, right? That's a cool call sign.
Yeah, he was a tough dude. It's funny to think back now. These guys were like maybe 26 or something. He seemed like old dudes. And he had to actually rip the wings off one doing BFM out over the Bering Straits one time. probably why he ended up as a P-38 instructor.
Holy crap! Like he was G-locked, great over G.
Yeah, he ripped a part of the, he ripped a whole big section of the of one of the wings off.
Good Lord,
landed it okay. But yeah, in fact, I remember it was I think it was 008 was the, he called Balls 8 was the his jet that he was flying that day with the part of the wing up. But he was a great guy, great instructor pop, very tough guy. But that's what I needed. I needed a guy that was gonna get me where I needed to be and flying that jet correctly. And I think I can say this. He had a couple things I'll never forget. One was, what are you doing? What are you thinking about? Where are you going? What are you doing? Be ahead of the thing, way ahead of the thing.
Yeah.
Because when he got me, I was behind the jet. And then his other thing was, you got a death grip on that stick, man. You got to hold it with two fingers like you're jerking off a mouse. Okay, is that family coming? Yeah.
Yeah. I don't, probably wouldn't fly today. He probably couldn't say that today. No.
I know, right? It's got to be a whole different thing, though. But I'll never forget that. And he taught me to hold that stick lightly and to fly with finesse and to be ahead of the airplane. And so I kind of caught back up to the class, and I was very excited to get an A-10 on assignment night. And actually, the number one guy in our class, Greg Woodrow, the German wing commander, said, I want Woody. And so Greg Woodrow, number one guy in our class, T-37 tape to Shepard. And he stayed there for 5 years. Oh. Trying to get a fighter, because by that time there was less cockpits and so he's trying to get a fighter and couldn't, and he ended up finally taking a C-130 to Little Rock, but then he went on to Hawaii. So this is another great story of a guy that was number one in the class and wanted to be a fighter pilot and would have been a great fighter pilot. The number two in our class, Scott Zobritz, just retired as a three-star. He was the 9th Air Force commander. He looks about 80 years old. Sorry, Zob. He was as fresh faced as I was at pilot training, but the burden of command is very difficult. I can tell on Zobit. Great guy, but the number one guy in our class, his dream in the Air Force never happened, but he made the best of it. He flew some of those new C-130s at Little Rock. He just wanted out of Shepherd. I mean, not, Shepherd's a great place, but his family wanted to move on, but that was a stepping stone for them to go to Hawaii, where his wife got breast cancer. But it was a great climate for her. There was a lot of physical activity that she could do to stay strong. She beat breast cancer. They raised three wonderful children. I think he retired as a brigadier, stayed in Hawaii the whole time out there at PACAF, and flew the C-17. So, you know, never flew a fighter, but had a great career, wonderful family, and you know, made the very most of it. And lived in paradise for most
of the time. Yeah.
So that's another great story, I think, you know, to motivate people. But Shanghai got a, it wasn't Shanghai yet. Shanghai got an A-10, very excited. And then a couple weeks later, the personnel folks came back and said, we need two of the A-10 guys to volunteer to fly the O-A-10, brand new thing.
O-A-10,
replacing the O-V-10s and some O-A-37s. As Ford Air Control airplanes with the A-10 airframe in a new role, O-A-10. Now, I want an F-16, right? So I'm thinking, okay, those guys that are Ford Air Controllers, the FACT, that's considered kind of a lesser job for a fighter pilot. So they usually do one tour on that and then get their choice of airplane unless they screw up. And so I'm thinking, my quickest way to an F-16 is the O-A-10.
Yeah.
And then I'm not stuck in the A-10. That's like this thing I said. I go fly the OA-10, new mission will be cool. And the first squadron was the 23rd Tactical Air Support Squadron, the Nail Facts, the Vietnam, storied unit. And they were at Davis-Monthan. So that's where the B course is, the RTU. And so so I was the first guy ever to go through the A-10 B course, but I wasn't going to fly an A-10. But that's all they had was the A-10 B course. So I went through the A-10 B course, and then they were putting together a syllabus for an OA-10 spin-up. And so the OA-10 squadron commander was very pleased when I was the top gun in my B course.
Wow.
Got that trophy, but I was going into an OA-10. So the dirtbag facts, I had the top guy in the B course in terms of bombing and such. So I was the first ever OA-10 guy And so it was initial cadre of the 23rd Task, OA-10. It was cool, single ship, shooting rockets. You know, it was awesome. And you
saw is it just a different mission for the A-10? I mean, physically, is it the same aircraft?
It is. It's the exact same airframe. And we had the gun, and we could use the gun. So it wasn't just like an OV-10. It was OA-10, so observation and attack, whereas previously had been the OA-37 was an observation and attack, because they had a mini gun they could strap on that thing and you know, shoot rockets as well. But normally it was Willie Pete rockets or white phosphorus marking. And the role of the airborne forward air controller in the tactical air control system as it was, you know, used back then, back in our day, before data link and all this stuff they have now.
Yeah.
I mean, the A-10 cockpit now would be a foreign place to me. I mean, I've seen it. It's, you know, it's helmet mounted sights and G-Wiz screens and touchscreen chip. I would not drink a drink in a bar with an A-10 person or an OA-10 person if they didn't have a grease pencil, first of all. And a boot knife. They had a boot knife and a grease pencil. I can have a drink with me. Otherwise, no. Take your helmet mounted queuing over there.
That's awesome. But, these kids these days, damn it.
Back in the day. But we wrote on the canopy with grease pencil and tried to keep track of you know, fighters and where they were and stacking them up and getting them into a target, working with the ground tactical air control party, usually a fighter pilot on the ground with an Army maneuver unit talking on the radio to you. But another thing, though, that they didn't tell us, the personnel people, was that if you volunteer for that OA-10, your primary job is not going to be as an OA-10 pilot. It is going to be as a battalion air liaison officer with an Army maneuver unit by name aligned to them. Ooh. So if they go to war, you don't go in a cockpit. You go on the ground with those guys. And you go train with them. And you don't live with them full time. But you go do exercise with them. You learn their stuff. And when the bubble goes up and they get called, you put your green suit, you put your BDUs on and you hump a bag out in the ground. So that was a little bit of a shocker. But fortunately for me, my unit at Fort Hood was transitioning from a light infantry, I think, to a mech or something in that nature. And so for the year that I was at DM, flying the OA-10 with the 23rd Task, they were not training, they were not mission ready. They were transitioning, and so I never met those guys. So I was not vulnerable to go to war on the ground. I did go to Army Air Ground Operations School, which is really a joint school for all the services. It's down at Hurlburt, Florida. Very cool school where we got to do cool things with Humvees and you know, learn how to navigate with the compass and more than we did at survival school.
What year is this?
This was 88 to 89. I was at DM. But then about 6 months into my first assignment, it's a 23rd Task, they're converting OV-10s to OA-10s at Suwon Air Base, South Korea, the 19th Tactical Air Support Squadron. And so now my thought is, hey, here's an even quicker route to an F-16, because if you go to Suwon, that's a short tour, meaning it's 1 year, no family. This is just a little corner of a South Korean base about 20 miles or so from Osan, the big American base. Yeah. And so it's quite austere, but it's really tip of the spear stuff. And we're going to go convert OA-10s there. And I'm one of the more experienced OA-10 guys as a first lieutenant now. And so,
that's awesome.
Hey, I'll do that. And so I leave my wife behind, 1 year in Tucson, which was gorgeous and, place. And then off to South Korea, a whole culture shock, I've been out of the country to Canada, you know, I grew up in Michigan, by the way. And so I've been to Canada, but when you get off that, you know, that civilian airliner, with minimal gear, your other stuff being shipped, and you walk into the Kimpo Airport and there's, you know, Korean guys with M16s, you know, guarding the place, and nobody speaks English and it's super crowded. It smells weird. And you don't know where you're going. You're some guy named Shrooms is picking you up from the squadron. And you don't even know where the squadron is or where Shrooms is or how to find him. And nobody's really talking to you in English. So that was a whole thing. And, It happened to be a Friday. And so I find him at the USO, and we throw my bag into the back of the, one of those little pickup trucks that we had back in the 80s and the 90s. And he goes blasting through the Korean highways with crazy traffic and no rules, it seems. And he's got that little four-cylinder thing, I think, going about 90, weaving in out of traffic. And I'm like, whoa. And then the mission is there. First Friday night for new guy, the FNG, friendly new guy, is the green bean, where you have a frag, an air tasking order, you got to memorize all this shit. And then you got to go downtown, and there's a refreshing beverage at each stop that must be imbibed. And I'm not a big drinker, so I am just blotto. Like, I don't remember. Wake up the next morning, and I'm in a little room, well-appointed, I guess, but somewhat austere and weird. And I look out the window, and there's a wall. There are guard towers. There's barbed wire. There's Korean guys walking back and forth with guns. I'm in jail. No, it's at the visiting officer's quarters at Suwon. It's just that high security. So it was, but it was a super awesome year, and I ended up being the first guy as a lieutenant to upgrade to four ship flight lead. Lieutenants did not upgrade to four ship flight lead back then. Wait till you went to that next assignment as a captain, but I just had the opportunity to excel because it's a whole new thing, and we didn't have that many guys. We didn't have a lot of rank and experience, and so and at Suwon we flew more. It was a super cool opportunity, and our squadron commander was this bachelor guy, an F-16 guy, but a cool guy nonetheless.
Yeah,
he was a great guy, and the rule was your wife could come over and visit like twice for a week or something. He's like, look, guys. We had this dormitory that was like studio apartments, and we had a little guy that shine our shoes and stuff for like me. Actually, I kind of realized this later. He made bank because we all paid him like $20 a month, right? And we're like cool guys, and he's doing our laundry and shining our shoes, and then I'm sure they're paying him. The Air Force is paying him too to be our houseboy. Houseboy was like 60-year-old guy, but it was cool. And the squadron man was like, if your wife is pleasant. And not a whiner, she can stay pretty much as long as she wants. So Angela was there about half of the year. My mid tour was at Christmas time, so we came home, and then we had our official honeymoon. It's like two and a half years after we married, at the Halikoa, which is a cool thing, at Waikiki, on Oahu, right next to the Royal Hawaiian. And Waikiki is this military hotel called the Halikoa, which is super low rate. Just for military folks, all ranks, book early, and it's one of the best spots on the island. And so we enjoyed that. And now in Korea, I was a battalion air liaison officer. In fact, my additional duty, because by the way, fighter pilots have additional duties, don't we?
It's true.
We do. I think it's a little even more so in the Navy, isn't it? You have more responsibility.
Oh, yeah. You'll be right there, maintenance officer or something.
Like, yeah, and actually in command of a bunch of enlisted people, right? Yeah. Yeah. Air Force pilot pilots are in command of anybody.
Ourselves.
Yeah, maybe most of the time. And so, but I was a battalion air liaison officer, but I was the chief battalion air liaison officer. So I had some influence on picking who was assigned to whom. So I was assigned to 3-2-1 Light Infantry, Schofield Barracks, Hawaii, right up there at the tip of, the top of Oahu. And it was a cool unit. I did a lot of neat stuff with them. Their battalion commander was like a little John Wayne. He was like Napoleon short, but John Wayne personality. And I did a whole two-week exercise on the northern island of Hokkaido, the northern Japanese island. In the fall, almost froze to death at night because I wasn't prepared. Didn't know we were going to be out there for 2 or 3 days.
Nobody told me.
Beautiful sunny fall day. I show up to the battalion talk in the tent, and the battalion commander says, "Air Force, you're on time for the briefing. Come on." And he said, "Where's your ruck?" And I didn't know what ruck was, and he had this southern accent. "Excuse me, sir. Where's your ruck, sir? I'm not understanding what you're asking me. Where's your gear, son?" "Oh, my backpack." Don't say backpack for the Army. "Oh, that's in the Hummers." So I had two guys that we call ROMADs, radio operators, maintainers, and drivers. Their AFSC was 271, I think. And they would operate the radios, keep those things going, and drive the Hummers, and have all my gear and stuff. But I was gonna go hit the pickup zone and do a helicopter to a hot LZ with the light infantry. And so I said, all my gear is in the Hummers. So, that's unfortunate because you're not gonna marry up with those Hummers for 2 or 3 days. Well, let me call them to get them over. No time. We're going to the PZ right now. So here we go. I got like summer flying boots. I maybe my winter ones. I've got BDUs on, the lightweight ones. I've got a jacket. I think it's a green flying jacket, summer weight. I've got the little army hat because it looked cool. You know? I got a map bag, a PRC 114 radio over my shoulder, and some flying gloves. You know, that's it. Normal socks and stuff. And it was a nice fall day when we left. It was a very cold, almost winter night that night. And I literally maybe would have frozen if it weren't for the artillery officer who had an extra hat and an extra jacket and some gloves and kind of geared me up a little bit. But there's a whole other cool story that goes on with that we don't have time for. But it was a great assignment. Until the four-ship check ride, the wing DO did not want me to be four-ship. He didn't even want me to have a check ride in the four-ship as a four-ship. I won't say his name or his initials even, but he was not a pleasant guy. And now the wing commander was all for it. So my four-ship check ride was me, my squadron commander, number two, wing commander, number three, wing DO, number four.
Wow.
And the wing DO does not want me to even be taking a ride, let alone passing. So we're going out to the range, doing a low level. In Korea, have you flown over there?
No.
Bad pollution. I mean, it's got to be even worse now. This is 1989. Depending on the sun angle, and our range was on the Yellow Sea, Kuni Range, and a lot of glare, a lot of difficult visibility conditions there.
Yeah.
And so navigating a four-ship, and it's hilly. And rugged, and you got to do a lot of clearing passes at that range, even though it's range control officer, because there's fishing boats that may be in there, and bombing a truck on a little spit of land out in the Yellow Sea, just off the coast. And number four keeps flying lower than the rest of us, right? So do that. Now blue four is going to be some young guy probably, and so a four ship flight lead, you'd expect in your check ride that somebody's going to maybe pull that one once, and you say four climb. He does, and you're all good, right? No, three or four times, Colonel so-and-so is flying lower than the rest of the flight. And so I correct him twice, and I'm thinking, okay, like, he knows what he's doing. Maybe he's not jacking with me. Maybe I should, let it slide this time because I've already corrected him twice. And, how much do you,
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
And the wing commander says, four climb. He does. He does it again. So I think, okay, hey, four, why don't you fly on back home, one to a full stop. We'll see you in the debrief. Yeah, I sent him home.
Nice.
Yeah, wouldn't you do that? That's what you do.
Yeah.
You're out there and the guy's having a bad day. You don't care if he's a colonel or a first lieutenant or whatever.
Yeah.
Not having a good day. It's a safety issue. Another member of the flight, his element lead has told him to climb, and he's back low again. So just send him home. That's the safe thing to do, I think. Yeah. Maybe not the exact perfect thing in that check ride scenario, but I thought, well, I think that's what I'm supposed to do. So I did. And we went. Now, he was a big, take money from the guys at the range kind of guy. He was a good bomber, and we had some good bets down on that. And so I knew he was going to be fuming mad because he didn't have the opportunity to take money from us, because he had told me that he had made sure that I understood that he did not approve of this ride whatsoever, but he was at least going to take money from me. And there's no way I was going to pass. So he said that before we left.
Wow.
So this was not retribution on my part, but it sure could have looked that way. And
so go home.
In his mind, it was not a good move. But we went and did our range, and we came back, and we did a couple of, I don't remember we did it. But it all went well. We land, and my squadron commander comes up and said, Colonel so-and-so is in the debrief room, and he's fuming there. it's not going to be pleasant in there for you, Shanghai. He said, but just stick to your guns. He said, I'll back you up. You did the right thing. He's blew four. Rank's not the issue here. It was unsafe. You sent him home. That's what you should do. There'll be some discussion whether you should send his element lead with him, but let's assume that he was experienced as he was. He was who he was, and not having a good day, you sent him home. I think that's the right call. We'll see. He said, I don't know how it's going to go. We'll see. But you'll get another ride at least. So I'm thinking, okay, I'm not going to pass it, but at least it's not like a business failure. And so so we get in the debrief room, and I start the thing, and you know, the ground ops, et cetera. And he wants to interrupt already and get into this, right? And so so I said, just a second. We'll get to that. What you want to talk about in the we talk about something inner to the range and et cetera. And then said, okay, you just have a bad day, I guess. You know, I mean, you know, you don't fly lower than your element lead, and he's not flying lower to me. You know, visibility is tough out there. And I imagine you were simulating that a little bit for my benefit in the ride. I caught it twice. The third time I really was vastly, and I'll be honest about what to do. And Wing Commander spoke up, your element lead spoke up as he should. The fourth time I just sent you home, because that's what I would do with a guy that's having a bad day. You're an experienced guy, so I didn't need to send your element lead with you. We went on and completed our training mission. I think that's why our commander took the money today. You know, so trying to diffuse it with a little humor. And he's standing up now and he's banging. And the wing commander stands up and says, first name, Howard. Howard, sit down. And if you can't keep your mouth shut, just leave. Because Sheehy did a great job, and he's a new four-ship flight lead. I'm buying the first round. And that was in the debrief. Yeah, that was it. Said, I'm buying the first round. Yeah. And so that was it. It was a great day, but it was also a very challenging day. And those things will happen, you know, and it won't always go that well.
Yeah, that's awesome.
But I've had a couple that didn't actually, but all those things are just opportunities to do your very best. And but it's uber competitive, as you know, as well. It really at a level that's not tremendously healthy, but probably necessary. Maybe a little different now. This is not a sexist remark by any means, ladies, but it's got to be a little different mixing genders together in a fighter squadron. I'm not saying it's better or worse or whatever. I mean, I have my opinion, but I'm not there. It seems to be working well. The ladies that are flying the A-10s are doing a great job, from what I hear, and distinguishing themselves and fitting in with the bros. So, you know, whatever. I just remember getting my wings and the German wing commander saying, "Welcome to the worldwide fraternity of military aviators, fighter pilots." And it was not a fraternity in the animal house sense, but great guys. I mean, and it's interesting too to think back at that. But there was a pretty clear pecking order, right? When you got, you know, when you were in the Navy, it had a lot to do with your landing scores, I guess, too, but also bombing, also BFM, ACM, et cetera. And you knew who the best guys were and who the not so best guys were, but the not so best guys were awesome, right?
The lowest is still the best in the world. Yeah.
I mean, they're still, you know, they still got a fighter and are flying that thing well. They may not be, you know, the best leader or the best bomber or the best tactical guy, but they'll hold their own. And then combat's a whole different thing, as I found out. But so in Korea, my wing commander or my bar commander calls me in one day, about a couple months before the end of my tour, and says, "You're my top guy. Where do you want to go?" He said, "Well, you don't even have to answer that. I got you an F-16 training slot to Luke already."
Yeah.
I'm like, thanks, boss. But I'm thinking I might want to stay in the A-10.
Oh.
I want to go fly the A-10 in England. He said, "No, they will ruin your career. The future of the Air Force is the F-16, my friend. You want to go to the F-16. I know it would be fun to go fly A-10s in England, low and here on fire and stuff. where there's a real mission to fold the gap. But you know what, Shanghai? About half of those guys in the fold the gap are going to die on the first day. The plan was to send the A-10s to the fold the gap to stop those tank hordes from coming from the east. But the SAM environment, the weather environment, the terrain environment was such that they thought we'd lose half the A-10s on the first day.
Wow.
So, that doesn't make you scared of the fight, but it makes you think maybe twice about the mission a little bit. And so, but I loved the airplane. I loved the A-10. The O-A-10 mission was cool. And so I wanted to go do the rest of that mission, the mission that I'd learned a little bit about in the B course and done well with. And it was just an airplane that I was really comfortable flying. I felt like I was ahead of most of the guys that were my peer group because of the experiences I had, all trying to get an F-16, which now I'm thinking maybe I don't want. Yeah. And it was a tough decision, though, because obviously there was a lot more F-16s being made and a lot of missions being formed around that airplane. But I talked to a couple of guys that were in pilot training with me who felt like at that point, in fact, one guy was down at Kunsan, Wolfpack. They had a lot of missions, as you know, probably Mover and all the missions, I think, for the F-16. And he felt like he was a jack of all trades and master of none a little bit.
Yeah.
And really trying to really work hard to fill all the training squares for all the different missions just to be mission qualified.
Right.
Not really, he didn't feel that it's, tremendously proficient. Plus, back then, the airplane was kind of a pig when you loaded up with a lot of stuff, a lot of ordnance, and you need a couple bags of gas. And, the airplane that you flew was probably the big block, late block, big motor.
Block 30, big mouth. Yeah.
Boom. Yeah. Yeah. And so, different airplane, too. But I decided I'm going to go fly the A-10 in England. So RAF Alconbury, two squadrons of A-10s, that went to 511 Vultures. And lo and behold, well, the first thing I get there, and the next weekend, 50th anniversary of the Battle of Britain. And that was the base where any Battle of Britain fighter pilot that was still alive that could get there shows up and is housed. There's a banquet. There's a private air show with the Heritage Flight and all that stuff.
That's awesome.
And we got to host all that. And so there I'm in the bar talking to Air Vice Marshal Johnny Johnson and Laddie Lucas. I mean, heroes of Johnny Johnson was a he was a Canadian, but he was the leading ace in the European theater for the British, the real integral in the Battle of Britain. One of the guys of whom Churchill said, "Never have so many owed so much to so few." The few were those Battle of Britain fighter pilots who really kept England from ever being invaded. And there I'm in the bar talking to those guys. Laddie Lucas comes up and says, "What are you drinking, Captain?" "The Connery Coke, sir." He said, "First of all, don't call me sir. I'm a fire pilot just like you." And he said, "The Connery Coke." I said, "What's it? It's Diet Coke and spiced rum." He goes, "That's not a manly drink." He said, "Barkeep, a G&T for the captain. Gimli's if you got it." "I'll teach you to drink gin and tonic." So there's Laddie Lucas teaching me to drink a gin and tonic at the bar in England.
Awesome.
How cool is that, right?
That is
and
cool.
It was really awesome. But then a couple months later, it wasn't so awesome because "Mr. Gorbachev, tear that wall down." And all of a sudden, there's no mission anymore. And part of the treaties that were coming after that was all the A-10s leave Europe. Four squadrons over at RAF Bentwater and two at Alconbury. And so there I am, hearing very loudly, as echoes, the words of my squadron commander. "You're going to ruin your career. The future is the F-16. I'm thinking the boss was right, and I have.
Future is now.
I've really messed this up. Here I was doing well, kind of thought I was sort of a fast burner, and now I'm helping, draw down a squadron with a mission in an airplane where I'm not going to get many flying hours in, and I could be at Luke flying F-16. So that was a little bit tough days, but I took a very challenging additional duty, chief of combat plans, which was a big thing because we had a whole safe. I mean, my desk was in this vault. And we had all these plans, and there's secret, and there's secret no foreign, and NATO secret, and we had to catalog all those, and we had to get them to the right place and dispose of them, and And as we drew the squadron down, and then Saddam Hussein invades Kuwait. Now things got really demoralizing because not only do we have no mission, but all the stateside boys are going to the desert.
Oh.
And they're probably going to be a shooting war.
Oh.
And so now this is a little tough for people to understand. And I don't even know how to explain it. Maybe you can help. But you don't want a war to happen. But if there's one that's going to be happening, you want in on it, don't you?
Yeah. You want to do what you're trained for.
Yeah. You've train. And some of the training is tremendously realistic. Red flags, et cetera. I got a great red flag stories as a A-10 guy. They didn't even take lieutenants. A-10, they didn't take back lieutenants to red flag. But we didn't have they didn't have enough captains. So there I am at red flag. I got some stories about that. That were very interesting too. Right outside the box, for instance. Back in the RFMDS days. And so anyway, but very realistic training opportunities, but it's not the real thing. And there's this thing where you know that you've got great equipment and you know you got great weapons and you know you got great intelligence. You think you know all this stuff, but do you really?
Yeah.
We know that we're great. We know that we train like we're gonna fight. And maybe the enemy doesn't as much. We are decentralized. They are centralized. We think we have a lot of advantages, but you don't really know. And so there you are, you know, the third largest army in the world, the fourth largest to count us, you know, amassed and dug in. And it's a desert, you know. What does an A-10 do in the desert? Remember, I mean, we fly
it's
low.
Green.
And
green, it's right? Green. It's the wrong color.
I was in a green airplane in the desert. That's right. That was green A-10s. Love them. And so, but I wanted it to be gray on that first mission. I'm not going to lie. But you know, it was a whole different deal. And there I am in England watching it happen, you know. And so, you can bellyache for a while and woe is me. It doesn't help. In fact, it's a detriment. But, or you can maybe prepare for something that probably won't happen, but might as well be doing something. So me and a couple of guys decided, we'd get with some of our buds that were in the desert, some of the guys from Myrtle Beach and in the Air Force Base and A-10 guys, and see what they're doing. What are you guys thinking? What are the tactics going to be? Are you doing any kind of training program? Can you send us some of that stuff? Because we'll do that here. We'll train our guys like you're training your guys over there. And so so me and the chief of training, we set about to make a little syllabus of desert tactics that we can do now on our few training flights. And then I'm thinking, yeah, but how would we even get there? Because, you know, the stateside guys, that's their AOR. So they got their risk kits and their sea land containers and their maintenance stuff and their transport and their tankers. And our job was within 12 hours to go from RF Falconberry across the English Channel to a pre-positioned place in Germany. Ours was Leipheim, where I got a locker with clothes. You know, we got beans, bullets, and bombs, and beds, and maintenance guys. And we don't need tankers. And, you know, that's what we did. And so how would we get, you know, 24 A-10s from England to the desert if they even need more?
Yeah.
So I set about making some plans where there were none. We had no plans for this. And so talking to embassies, how are we going to get we got to get tankers. So we need secondary delivery group. If we can't get tankers, we got to stop somewhere for gas. Sigonella. But will France let us overfly with live ordnance? Well, they didn't. We had to go around the horn.
Yeah, yeah.
But
yeah.
All this stuff, and just putting it together. What if, you know? Might as well be doing something. And so the 3rd Air Force commander would come fly with us occasionally, General Link, the boss would pair me up with him some, and I was doing an IP upgrade now, starting that, which again was controversial because my time was OA-10 time. And so I'm in the A-10 world, but same airplane, some different missions. But mission is gone. So we're doing desert tactics. And so I was kind of at the forefront of that. And so we briefed something very simple with the general. And then, general, we've got about 30 minutes before we got to step address to fly. We've got a briefing, Colonel O'Connor's leading the main briefing, contingency plans for Operation Desert Shield. Would you like to sit in? Sure. And we give a dog and pony show about how we would get there and what we would do and what we're doing for training and just trying to impress the general that if there's any more A-10s necessary, we thought, well, it has to come from England because all the stateside guys are gone. If the USC used Guard or Reserve, they wouldn't do that, would they? Back then, it was, you know, it probably, we thought they wouldn't. And yeah. So lo and behold, rumors have it, they need another squadron of A-10s. The Cajuns, the reserve guys from New Orleans go, right?
Yeah, both, 706.
Colonel Efferson, Bill Folsom, you knew a lot of those guys, didn't you? Yeah. Good guys. Great squadron, great guys. The second best choice after the 511th would have been those guys. But there they go. The reserve guys are going to the desert. So we're dorks. But about 2 weeks later, rumors again. They may want another squadron of A-10s. Now they're going to have to come from England. Because we weren't even in some of the reserve, some of the guard guys were like, just getting A-10s or switching out to F-16s or whatever. One was going to F-15s, I think. And so, but we thought, yeah, but those four squadrons at Bentwaters, they'll take all the best guys and make a super squadron, and they'll do that because that's kind of what we thought to do. And there was talk about that. But then one day, I'm about ready to fly, about 2 weeks before Thanksgiving, 1990. And Colonel O'Connor, squadron commander, comes over to the public address system of the squadron. Captain Sheehy, report to my office. Now, he would never say that. First of all, he'd never call me at his office when I was getting ready to fly. He'd say, Shanghai, come see me. Later. I'm thinking, that's weird. He's going to be standing at attention at his desk. And General Link is on the speakerphone. General Link's on the speakerphone. I'm thinking, shit. Now, Princess Ferguson, Duchess of wherever, married to Prince Philip, who was a Royal Navy helicopter pilot, right? She's learning to fly helicopters, and so as a civilian. And so whenever the Royals flew, it was called purple airspace. And so you didn't, you know, it's just like the president, you don't fly in a purple airspace. So we'd be doing low levels, and she's out there debopping in some helicopter, you know, like some guy Mover's been doing about there recently. And
I am a princess. What can I say?
There you go, And so and sometimes they'd change the route. Well, I'm going to go to Kensington Castle instead of Windsor Castle or whatever. And you know, if you're already in the air, you may not get that change of route. And so, if you know, I'm thinking, oh, man, I flew with the general just a week or so before, and she was in the air that day, and we had the whole route. What if they change it? If a three-star violated purple airspace, it's going to be a big international incident, and I'm the dweeb. And so I'm thinking that, all of a sudden, the general's like, O'Connor, that dirtbag captain. And he's kind of talking. That dirtbag captain better be standing at attention. He is, sir. He is, General. Sheehy, do you think you're pulling the wool over the old man's eyes in a bullshit dog and pony show contingency plan briefing? So I started answering, O'Connor, did you give him permission to speak? I'm like, what in the world, man? What have I done? All I've done has been just not helpful. It's been a disaster since I got to England. What did I do? I really messed this up. And then the general starts laughing a little bit. And Colonel O'Connor's got a smile. And he said, so you want to go to the desert, do you? Pack your bags. Expletive deleted. there we go. He said, you guys are great. All that planning that you did, awesome. You're ready to go. There's nobody I would pick besides you guys. Super squadron at Bentwaters. 511. That's my guys. That's who I'm picking.
And nice. So
go do me proud.
Yes.
Go. So I spent that holidays in the vault. I'd go in. It was dark. I'd come out. It was dark. I think I ate Thanksgiving dinner. We left the day after Christmas, which in England they call Boxing Day. They give little anonymous gifts to people. But it's a bank holiday. And so, as they call it there. So air traffic control was a little bit of a challenge to get. We took 26 airplanes off to get 24 across the tankers over the English Channel. And then all the way around, because we couldn't both fly France. And I spent hours and hours and hours with the embassy. We just couldn't do it. And then we actually, RON at Sigonella, remained overnight to get other tankers over in the Med to take us as far as just down the Red Sea. And then as we went feet dry in the Saudi, they turned around and we cooled down our AIM-9s and we're ready to fight our way in if we needed to, because
this is like
December 26th. All of the peace talks have pretty much broken down to try to get a negotiated withdrawal from Kuwait. And so we flew all the way across with two bags of gas but nothing like the Myrtle Beach guys. You know, the first squadron of A-10s that was there about 13, 14 hours after the invasion, they were at Al Jubail, which is ended up being the Marine Harrier Base, a little bit further north than where we ended up bedding down at King Fahd in Dahran. But they were it. They were the front line of own troops. It was a squadron of A-10s. They had the rounds they had in the gun, the fuel they got in their bags in their airplanes, and rudimentary tents and stuff. That's what they had for a few days until the airlift came. And so if Saddam would have rolled into Saudi, they would have faced a squadron of A-10s, and that's about it for those first few days. When we got there, when we flew into King Fahd that night, it was a city. I mean, you know, it was an airport under construction, an international airport, two massive runways. You can imagine with the density altitude there, they're massive, massive runways, two massive runways, a parking garage that became the Garage Mahal, where the 101st Airborne bedded down, and a mosque, of course, they built that first with gold roof, and that was called the King's Ramp, and that's where the A-10s were. We had a warehouse building that was our squadron ops building, revetments, GPS coordinates. GPS, we didn't have a GPS, but we had really pristine coordinates from an Army Hummer with the GPS on it for our inertial navigation system, because that's what real men fly with in an A-10, inertial navigation. A grease pencil and a map and a calendar. Right? And so, so now we had to get up to speed with that place. And some real training in the desert. I think we had maybe five or six rides in the 3 weeks before the war started. So we were the last squadron in, and when the thing went off, it was just awesome. I mean, we knew it was getting close. I was chief of combat plan still, and so the ATO came in, execute Wolfpack. I may have a copy of that in my safe. But the night before that, we didn't know the ATO was coming, but the night before that was Buster Glosson, three-star, comes to the base. He was going to all the fighter bases. We were in a bubble hangar, only pilots, I mean, guards at the door. And you could, there's probably 200 of us, because there's all the A-10 guys, and then there's some F-16 guys. And you can hear a pin drop when in comes Buster Glosson, big guy, you know, three stars in his flight suit, big burly guy, every colonel in the world, you know. And he gets up on an engine changing stand. It's the only thing in there. And he just looks at us. And a pin drop. And he says, no, everybody's breathless. And he's a big guy. He doesn't need a bullhorn or anything. He says, gentlemen, you are about to be part of the largest use of air power in the history of air power.
Yeah.
We're not warmongers. We're just ready to go. Let's do this thing. And that was him saying, we're not going to just, you know, mosey up there a little bit. We're going to go. And he went on to tell a story. I know we're probably running out of time, but he went on to tell a story, and it was this. He's like, I was a young lieutenant in Vietnam flying F-4s. One time we lost half our flight on a mission. He said, it was BS. We're flying the same headings, the same routes, the same ordnance, the same targets, every day, same time. Stupid. Washington. Bean counters telling us how to fly tactics. So I remember after we lost half our flight, we're in a hooch having some beers. He said, by the way, there's no beers in this war. Dry war. Probably a good thing, he said. But we're having some beers. And he said, I remember saying, if I'm ever in charge of one of these genie things, it's going to be different. Well, guess what, guys? I'm kind of in charge of this one. And it is going to be different. He said, you guys are the best. You got great airplanes. You got great weapons. You got great maintainers. You got great tactics. You guys, your flight leads are sharp. You know what to do. We're going to just let you do it. Make decisions up there.
Nice.
He said, but this is going to be tough. The third largest army in the world. And they're dug in. They've been there for 6 months. And it's their land. But we're going to take everything we got from day one. But I need everything we got for day two and day 20 and day whatever. I don't know how long this thing's going to be. It may be a month. It may be 6 months. It may be a year or two. But I'll tell you this. There's no 100 missions to go home, guys. You're what I got. I got your airplanes, and I got you guys. We don't got replacements. There's no replacements. There's no rotation. It's we're going to do it until it's done, and then we'll go home. So you got to be smart, he said. We're going to let you make decisions, but make smart decisions. Because, guys, there is nothing on the ground in Iraq or Kuwait worth dying for today. We got no boots on the ground, and we're not gonna for a while. He said, miracle of miracles, we've convinced our Army counterparts, such as the guy in command, General Schwarzkopf. He said, who is a great guy, by the way. He said, we've convinced them that for a while, let's just go at them with air power. Soften them up a bit. It takes a boot to get a boot off the ground. But for a while, we're just going to use air power. And so we're emboldened. We're excited. And we know that the lessons of Vietnam, hard learned, were not going to be the repeated mistakes of this war. That our senior leadership, we had like three guys flying A-10s who had ever seen combat. This whole generation that hadn't seen combat.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Groth Wilson was like a forward air controller in like 02s or 01, actually, I think, in Vietnam. And I remember the next night, Groth's the general speech was just so inspiring, and we were just excited to get going. Scared, you know, apprehensive, but ready. And that next night, Groth says, I'm going to give you guys a real speech. Anybody know what AAA looks like? We knew how high a 57 millimeter would go, and you know, but what does it look like? Yeah, it's a pretty good thing to know. Like what when it's blowing up around you, what is that? And so he had a dry erase board. Actually, I think it was no kidding, like with those old boards with the boards we used to have in school. Before the dry erase boards was the chalkboard. It's a chalkboard. And he's drawing the circle. 57 millimeter looks like a big cloud with a dark center. And then 23 millimeters like popcorn. You know? So that's kind of good to know. And guys, by the way, you don't see tracers from the air, guys. The tracers are coming up. So it's cool. So he's telling us this stuff because he's like one of got him and like the two wing commanders. They had a provisional wing with the Myrtle Beach commander and the England Air Force Base commander as co-wing commanders. And so it was like the only guys that had seen combat. And so old girl telling us about that. And so we're ready to go. But as chief of combat plans, I had to get the ATO. Had a couple of enlisted guys help me break that out and get it to scheduling. So I couldn't fly that first night. My squadron commander actually led the first A-10 off the ramp, off the place. I had to go way out to western Iraq with Apaches to joint air attack against border radar sites. So that was cool. But I'm stuck in the squadron ops. But I got the ATO, and we're watching CNN. Because you know Fox News didn't exist. Watching CNN over a BBC feed on a satellite, and I had kind of figured out pretty close what the delay was in time, and I think. And so I'm looking at the frag, and I'm watching Bernard Shaw on the on the roof of the hotel, Al Rashid Hotel in Baghdad. The skies over Baghdad are illuminated tonight. Wolf Blitzer. And I said to my guys, I said, in about 30 seconds. He's going off the air. How do you know that? And so it was about 35 seconds. But I'm looking at the frag, two F-117s, four 2,000-pound bombs between them, the AT&T central switching station in Baghdad, down the air shaft of the high-rise building that housed that facility.
Oh, awesome.
Phones are going off. And, of course, back in those days, he's talking on the phone line. So back to – we've lost Bernie, and we hope he's okay. Yeah, he's fine. AT&T's not fine anymore. They'll get him on. So about 5 minutes later, he's on a satellite phone as well. But that's how precise that thing was. The first 3 days were pre-planned. It was an awesome thing. I was sitting alert the second day, about ODAR 30. Got to the APU going, checked everything out. Got a little nose wheel strain problem, but that's okay. And just settling in, waiting for some tasking. And then the air raid sirens go off. It's the first time that's happened. The base goes dark. The guys are coming out of the control tower. And you launch for survival. If you've got APUs running, you fire up your engines and launch. So So there I'm about 15 revetments from my wingman. Now we did a thing called combat pairs. I don't know if they still do that, but we, when we spun up our training program, we took flight leads and wingmen and paired them up and trained together extensively. And so my number two guy was Sparky, Scott Johnson. Great guy, Air Force Academy grad. But his first assignment was backseat in F-4s in Europe, where it was one pass, fall ass, toss a nuke. That was their thing. And he was a great wizzo and a great guy and got to go to pilot training. So he's a captain. He's senior to me by a couple of years, but he's new to flying front seat, only seat, single seat. That's the way to go in the mover, single seat for
Jamal. Yeah, rather have the extra gas.
No, we don't want another seat. No way. And and so I don't know what you do with it. And so he was a great wingman. I flew 44 combat missions. He was my number two on 36 of them.
Wow.
And so Sparky's down the way, and I said, "Spark, I'll meet you down at EOR in the end of runway where they'll pull all your pins and check you over." But there's nobody down at the EOR. And my nose wheel steering's not working either, so I'm using differential power to turn the thing, but that's okay. Get down to the EOR, nobody's there. They're all in mop gear in a bunker, right? And as I see the bunker, it's pitch dark. I think, okay, they don't even know we're here. So I kind of move the throttles up, turn my landing light on, and kind of get the airplane, do an elephant, you know, to swing my landing light across the front of that bunker to alert them we're here. Here they come, Casper the Ghost. The guy's all in mop gear. They probably set a world record for arming two A-10s back into the bunker. And I look, nobody in the control tower. I don't see any landing lights. It's Sparky, take 20 seconds. We're rolling. And so off we go. And throttles, here we go, lumbering down the thing, 55,000 pound airplane. I've never flown an airplane with that heavy. It's max gross weight. We have 18,000 pounds of gas and 18,000 pounds of ordnance on a thing. And here we go, long runway. It's morning. It's not warm yet. It's winter, maybe 70 degrees. So I should be getting off the ground soon. And I'm just, the thing's just, I can't get my nose wheel off the ground. Like, what in the world? Checking everything over, everything's good. Finally, I lumber into the air, gear up, flaps up. Oops, didn't put the flaps down. In the fog of war, that first mission, everything going on, everything I was trying to keep track of, and a little mechanical problem, I made a buffoon mistake and did not put the flaps down to take off flaps setting. And that makes a big difference, as you know, in the takeoff roll, especially on a max gross weight airplane. Had it been warmer, I mean, maybe wouldn't have gotten off the ground.
You could have skipped.
So, yeah, exactly. Not a desert. It's like talcum powder. I probably wouldn't have sucked. But and say, Sparky, check your flaps, and then keep going. Now, I got nobody to talk to. I know freak. There's airplanes everywhere, seemingly. There's lights everywhere. We're jamming our own comms. The radios were just really bad. The weather was bad. Turns out that was the worst winter weather in the Arabian Peninsula ever for storms, thunderstorms, a lot of rain. And it starts raining about 5 miles off the end of the runway as I'm turning so far you can rejoin. And I figure, well, and of course, we have no radar on the A-10. And there's just airplanes all over the place. And they've got radar. Hope they see me. I'm not talking to anybody. There's no, I'm trying to get a direct air support center, it'd be like a sector radar center. Can't get anybody on the radio. All the freaks are trash. And I'm thinking, this is not going well either. And so I'm going to fly up the coast towards Jubail. Maybe I'll get those guys on the radio. So I do. I get the Marine desk on the radio. They give me a freak, a tasking, somebody to talk to. I'm like, somebody to talk to, like up there. And the Iraqis were shelling the oil refinery at Al Kopchi, just over the border into Saudi Arabia. It's on fire. And so those artillery batteries, there were three of them. They were in the parking lot of like a Home Depot type place, just up the coast, about 50 miles up the coast in Kuwait. And that's our target. The sun is just starting to come over the horizon. The clouds are up above. We're in a green airplane, white billowy clouds. And as we go, our feet wet just off the coast, there's Kuwait, and then the lights show, the barrels, the muzzle flashes down below. "Ooh, we're getting shot at, Mover." This is, you know, because it looks like flying up the coast of Florida on a nice morning. You know, there's the coastal highway, there's the condos and hotels, all evacuated. There's the Home Depot. Oh, what's that? The parking lot. The muzzle flashes, and old Grove Wilson. We're seeing the big clouds with the dark centers. This is a real thing, and so I see the target. We climb. I'm going to roll in for bombs. Barkey's going to be in cover. I'm inverted, just rolling, just pulling down, about to roll out, probably a little shallow. And I think Springfield was my call sign. Zip gun, whatever. Break right, Chapler. Sparky's calling me. Missile shot at me. First pass. Right? And so now I'm inverted. So I kind of dish out. I kind of jink, chaff and flares. And of course, in the A-10, you go downhill. You want to turn into the missile to create turning problems for it, but you need energy, and the thing will turn around, you know, a horseshoe, but it's going to lose lots of energy doing it. And so got to go downhill. So there I am looking out the top of the canopy, which is the ground, and here is a big white conical smoke trail, SA-7 or SA-14. You know, I know from that smoke trail it's a shoulder-fired heat-seeking missile. I know the numbers and of that thing, and it's the weirdest thing. I don't know if you've ever experienced this in a fight or anything else, but temporal distortion.
Yeah.
So it was like 38 seconds, as I recall, from his call to the end of this engagement with the missile, 38 terrifying seconds. But in those 38 seconds, I clearly saw the first ever weapons briefing that I was ever in back in Tucson. My next door neighbor was Joe Prodakis, our brand new shiny lieutenant intel guy. And there he is in our little squadron briefing room. And he's standing on stage and press BDUs. And he's telling us about SA-7-14. And he's telling us all the numbers. And I remember I can see him saying this just clear as I'm looking at you. The last ditch maneuver to defeat the SA-7-14 is a 5G orthogonal roll around the missile just prior to missile impact. Cool. Briefing over, let's go to the bar. But now I'm mad. I'm mad at Joe. I'm mad at me. I'm mad at every swinging thing in the squadron. Can't say that anymore either. Because nobody thought to say, "Hey, Joe, what's just part of missile impact? How do we know when that is? Is that now? Is that a couple seconds ago? What does that look like, man?" Like Grohl telling us what the 57 millimeter looked like. It's a neat thing to know. But when do you do that? You know,
yeah,
you
don't think
about those little things that separate training from the real world. And so I thought, I guess I'll do it now. So I start this, you know, 5G barrel roll, and the smoke trail stops. It was just shot just slightly out of range, ran out of gas from about me to across the street. I mean, literally maybe 100 yards. I see the whole missile. I see the aft end glowing orange as it's falling off towards the Persian Gulf. And I clean out my flight suit and climb and go. And this is my thought. What the hell have I gotten this into? I mean, really, this was scary.
Yeah.
It was not anything like I thought it would be. It was just surreal, this temporal distortion thing. Where, Joe, what the hell? And then you think, do we really know what we need to know? Because that was a thing that I needed to know that I never thought of, and it almost got me killed. And it was an SA-14, clearly, because as I'm putting flares out, it's staying at the same place in my canopy. And so I am not defeating that thing with flares because, you know, it's like a stinger post. But so I knew which missile it was. That part of the briefing, you know, was helpful. But there was nothing I was going to do to defeat that missile except outturn it at the very end game. And I hope I started that turn soon enough.
Yeah.
Fortunately, the guy shot it a little bit out of range. But that was my first pass in combat. And we stood off the coast and tried to get a Maverick locked up on the artillery tubes. That wasn't helpful. That wasn't working. And I thought about General Glosson's briefing. He said, if the target's not as brief, if the threat is not as brief, if the weather is bad, bring it home. We'll figure out another plan and go back. Don't press a bad situation and get your ass handed to you because we need you and we need your plan. And I thought, this is what he was talking about. And part of it, frankly, was, I mean, I could have maybe made some attempt on that target, but part of it was I was just done. I mean, it was a lot from the launch for survival to the we don't know who to talk to to the, you know, weather, to the, I got a missile shot at me in my first pass. It was a lot. It was pretty frazzled. And so I hadn't slept the night before much. And so I said, Sparky, let's take it back home. And so there we land. CNN's there. My parents even saw me on TV. They said, as I taxied in, they wouldn't know I got all my shit hanging on the airplane still and dropping anything. So there I am, triumphant, I'm home. And we went back. We did make another plan. We took a four ship. A couple hours later, the sun was high. The clouds were gone. I knew where the target was. We came from four different axes. In about 2 minutes, we put like, you know, whatever, 48 CBUs or something across the thing. And, you know, blew the whole thing off the face of the earth. Awesome. Much better. It got pretty much better from there. There was a lot of AAA. There were a lot of missiles. There was an air threat initially, but, you know, anything they flew, we shut down. Our air supremacy was just unbelievable. The thing was going well. We were flying tons of sorties. We had one squadron that was just doing nights using a Maverick as a poor man's FLIR. Were very successful. They devised a whole bunch of like night tactics for the desert using a double IR Maverick as a FLIR essentially. And the Iraqis knew not to move their stuff except at night. And even then, they were probably going to get targeted. And you'd see the video was a BTR video, of course, back then. But you'd see these vehicles on a road. The night guys are targeting. They schwack the first vehicle. They schwack the last vehicle. And all these guys abandon their vehicles. They look like Casper the Ghost, you know, white on dark, hot on a light on a colder target like the desert. And here they are running off into the desert. You know, we didn't want to kill people anymore. We had to. A lot of the soldiers were conscripts that were down in the front lines. But we wanted all their vehicles. Abandon your vehicle. We're going to destroy it. You know, move away. And we did. Set up the whole area of Kuwait into kill boxes of 15 miles by 15 miles numbered and such. And so you would get a tasking that would be maybe like Alpha Fox 5. It's a kill box. Targets of opportunity. If you check in with a forward air controller, he's got a particular target, that one. After that, use your remaining gas and ordnance wisely for targets of opportunity, artillery and armor. Wow. And you get to the point where my forward air controller experience came in very handy because I'm up there with binoculars looking in those revetments to see, you know, where the AAA is going, to see which tanks look dead. I wrote a paper after the war. We got to brief it to the Joint Ordnance Commanders Conference about A-10 effectiveness in the war, and about that targeting. A tank with a bunch of 30 millimeter holes in it that's trash next to a tank that's okay look about the same from 15,000-20,000 feet.
Yeah,
it may even look the same in targeting imagery. If there's not a generator running, they're both hulks. If there is, the one with the generator is probably the one you want to, you know, a little hotspot, maybe the one you want to target. We had the issue of the desert being hotter than generators sometimes. And so, looking at a cooler target on a darker, hotter background. But you want to be using your ordnance wisely. You want to be diminishing our capability methodically. And we did that. One thing we learned was that, well, you can't see the tracers coming right up below you. You can sometimes see the ones over in the kill box, two or three over, and sometimes you have guys and they're jinking and you know, keeping the airplanes moving and being tactical, but you're loitering over the target for maybe 30, 45 minutes in the target area, in the threat environment, to identify and destroy the right targets. And sometimes you'd see guys in the kill box a few over and say, hey guys, you're really getting hosed over there, you know, keep those airplanes moving. And they didn't realize how much AAA is coming up at them.
Yeah,
right above it, but you could obliquely, it was super scary at the beginning. I seriously flew home that first mission thinking, what have I gotten our squadron into? I mean, I've really gripped with this thought I thought I snatched victory out of jaws of defeat of the whole England and F-16s and A-10 thing, and now here I'm in a war because that's where you want to be. and we wanted to be there, and I got us there. I mean, really worked super hard to make us be there. And man, I don't know if I can come do this again. I mean, how do you make yourself come do it again? I never would, but you think, wow, this was really, really tough. And I got to go do this again later today. Oof. And so you get the fortitude together to do that. You get a better plan and you get used to it. It's amazing what you get used to. And one thing we learned though is when we do surges in training, how many times can we fly the airplane in a day and shoot the gun out and all that stuff? We could fly the airplane 9 or 10 times. We fly the pilots three flights a day. We couldn't do that in combat. We started to do it. I flew three times one day, and they had to help you out of the cockpit by the end of the day. You're strapped into the thing for 15, 16 hours, hot pit intel briefs, and go again. And and you could do that. You had to hit tankers a lot of times, you know, to for the distances. We didn't carry external bags of gas or drop gas like you guys did in the extra team. And so tankers was a thing. Tankers in the weather was a thing. You could do that and be up, but coming home after that, once you're out of the target area after that third mission, there's just such a drain of you physically that critical phase of landing back at the very busy base became a challenge more than it should. And so we'd fly maybe two, have a day off, fly one, manage the schedule better like that for some crew rest and wasn't a lot of relaxation. We spent a lot of time in the night in mop gear in the bunker once we started slinging studs around and such. But then when he started slinging studs towards Tel Aviv, then the mission of the A-10 became presidentially directed, go find those scud missile launchers. So we used Al Juf, a little civilian airport way out in far western Saudi Arabia, north, and the Cajuns were put in charge of that. Colonel Epperson and Grove out at Al Juf. Colonel Epperson, a Creole chef, Cajun chef. And so they've had all this stuff thrown in from New Orleans, and he made feasts. And we would have six A-10s out there. The ramp was small. We lived in the place where the firefighters would normally be on that base, that airfield. And Colonel Epson cooked for us, and it was awesome. And I was out there for a week. I landed from a flight with Sparky. One day, and Grove comes up to me, and he's almost kind of like annoyed. He's like, Shanghai, you got Sandy experience, right? And I said, yeah, I'm Sandy qualified. I said, you, me, and Colonel F are flying a SAR. Come on, we're gonna go get briefed. Like, okay. So next thing you know, I'm in the warehouse building next to the fire station, and it's like a James Bond movie. Now today it would look like some kid's video game, but there was stuff there I'd never seen before. High speed stuff. The British SAS are in there. I didn't even know they were there. And they're in there, and they've got comm gear and stuff that I didn't even know what it was. And so it was a no-kidding SAR. There was a British tornado pilots that were down up near Baghdad. The backseater had come up on the radio. They had two good shoots out of the thing. And so they're out on western, just the outskirts of Baghdad. It's, you know, right near downtown Baghdad. And broad daylight. And here we go, three A-10s. We had a tanker, we had an AWACS, we had two paved loads, the whole thing, briefed the whole thing up, and here we go. Colonel Epperson, Gross leading it, Colonel Epperson and me, and up we go. And I think we had the distinction of the A-10s closest to Baghdad. I mean, it was literally like there's downtown Baghdad right there. It was really, really weird. And a lot of beeps and squeaks on the radar warning receiver. And then two MiG-25s. Scrambled, but the F-15 boys, here they come. We have a cap of four F-15, and all the, here they come streaking overhead, missiles flying, splash. It was cool. It was like Iron Eagle. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. It was really cool. And the thing that wasn't awesome is that we didn't get the guys out. The front seater had been picked up almost immediately, apparently, and the back seater had evaded out onto by a highway. And flagged down a vehicle that he felt like was not military, and it wasn't, but the truck stopped, the guy turned him in. And so those guys were both captured, but we went up and did our best and tried to get them out, but long distances. And, when you punch out right near downtown, it'd be pretty tough to find a hole to crawl into till the guys come get you. We'd had a very successful search and rescue with Paul Johnson, who went on to become a four-star, I think. But on the way back, I'm on the left wing, and we had taken a route that was a little more easterly than we'd come up initially, and I think it was to hit a tanker. And we were near this town of New Kive, and there was a sector operation center. The Iraqis had that on night one of the war was bombed, big radar site. And I see that off in the distance, but all around the sector operation center are revetments. I mean, hundreds of them. So I called that to Colonel Efferson's attention, or Gross' attention, and we took a little side trip over there. And it's a pink, like, regiment, like a whole, like, probably a numbered army. Hundreds of tanks, all dug in, kind of like reserve. They moved them out there, out into the western Iraq area, I think to hold them in reserve and maybe try to do an end around or something. Because, of course, the media had been duped into feeding false information that we were going to do an amphibious assault, because that's what we do, right? The Marines hit the beach. So they had fortified that beach in Kuwait tremendously. And so I think they took these tanks out way out in western Iraq to hold them in reserve and maybe do a flanking maneuver later. We found them, because normally it wouldn't be really much traffic out there. It's kind of middle of nowhere. There was an airfield about 30, 40 miles further to the west, but the sector operations center was destroyed. And so probably wouldn't have been much interest in that area. And so our little failed SAR found all these tanks. And so for the next 2 days, I was on almost every flight, three and then two, to go up against those things, because I had the knowledge of which revetments. We just methodically started blasting those things. But on the second day of that, my airplane was hit. I was leading a three ship. I was rolling into strafe. We were doing high angle strafe. We're doing like 60 degrees strafe with speed brakes out. Three targets. Reposition. And except for the breastplate on a main battle tank, any other area of that tank will be penetrated by a 30 millimeter armor piercing incendiary round from outside of a mile. But the top of the turret will glow. It will literally be melting as you're strafing it. So we do like three target strafe, 60 degrees of dive with speed brake. So I'm doing that. And I get the gun on safe light. The gun stops firing. Gun on safe light comes on. The gun is tremendously reliable, hardly ever jams or has any issues. But gun on safe means that Gatling gun is not going to complete its clearing and cooling cycle, which it does, obviously move backwards to clear unspent rounds out of the barrels, seven-barrel gun, and also to cool it with ram air evenly. It just occasionally will go chunk, 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 and so it's cooling those barrels evenly. Well, the gun on safe light means that's not going to happen. So you're going to have rounds, hot rounds in the chamber, and you're not going to get cooling. The barrels may warp. But then other caution lights start coming out as well. Of course, immediately with any of those, I call a knock it off. We start heading south. We get over Saudi airspace. We're about 100 miles into Iraq. We get over Saudi airspace. We do a battle damage check. Sparks says it looks okay. He doesn't see anything hanging or falling off the airplane. So I think I just got it now to one engine is running a little hot, a little rough, but it's okay. We didn't see any significant battle damage. I think maybe I just got some, kind of a foul round or something, but that's unusual. So I let those guys land, and there's no hot gun area there. It's just pointing off in the desert. So I let those guys land and clear. I get up in the runway, point out in the desert, and sign off the forms, gun and say, getting in the van. And the crew chief says, "Hey, sir, is there any problem with the engines?" I said, "Yeah, they put it in there. The right engine's just a little hot, little rough." I said, "Yeah, come here." There's about a quarter size piece missing out of every fan blade on that engine. Holes in the cowling on the side, holes in the cowling on the bottom. He's tried to open the door to put the pin in to safe the gun. Pieces fall out in the gun. There's holes in the side of the fuselage. So I got hit by anti-aircraft artillery, probably 57 or 37 millimeter, underneath the nose. It had chewed up the gun gears, spit it out the side of the fuselage, sucked it down the engine, which is a turbo fan engine.
Yeah.
Most of it went through the bypass area. But it turns out it borescoped it, and it also ingested pieces of the gun gear through the hot section. The engine never ran again. It got me all the way home.
Holy crap.
I didn't even really baby at home. And we had a tanker too, by the way, on the way home. And so
you tanked with that?
Yeah, I tanked with that. Yeah.
Oh wow.
That's the thing too in combat. You sometimes make some choices that in peacetime you would never do, like that. But I needed gas. You know, what are you going to do? There's no place else to land. We're out in western Iraq. You got Al-Juf or ditch. You know, or punch out.
Yeah, yeah. So, wow.
I mean, you couldn't go to Jordan. You couldn't go to Syria. So the tanker guy takes his chance, and you take your chance with a hot gun refueling. You know, in an A-10. We refueled in a thunderstorm one time. Literally, it's early morning. Sparky got hit on his left wing with lightning. It arced to my right wing. We're in close formation because we're in and out of heavy storm, heavy rain. We're about 3,000 feet underneath thunderstorm. The tanker's at like 20,000 feet in the track. I got to hit the tanker before the target. It's just solid lightning. You know, we hear the thunder even, and it's rough. We're below it. He's above it talking to him. And all of a sudden, no radios, no lights in my cockpit. My right arm is shaking off the stick. I've hold it with the left hand because he got hit by lightning, arced to my airplane, shocked me. And I'm reaching down, I'm holding the stick, got this hand shaking. Intermittently, there's no autopilot in the engine. And with all that stuff hanging, it doesn't trim up very well. I'm trying to push circuit breakers in. And finally, some lights crackle back on, radios crackle back. And Sparky's like, was that lightning? Yeah. Arm still shaking. But now we got to find the tanker. And so he's about 100 miles north of me. And he says he's got some sucker holes below him. I'm just solid clouds and lightning and heavy rain. And so he said, I'll try to come down. So here he is, big airplane full of gas, right? Trying to come down through a hole in a thunderstorm to tank up a couple of A-10s. And so he says he's Popeye, in and out of the clouds. At like base, whatever, 5,000. I'm at 3,000. I said, go Christmas tree. He turns on all the lights. He's got it's like a city over here. Said, I'll turn on you. I put Sparky on the left wing. Now, Sparky was a great guy, not the best refueler. the A-10 is F-16, you fuel behind you, right? A-10, it's in the nose, it's right there. And so, you think that might be easier in some respects, it may be, but there's a tendency to chase that boom, to get in a little. Pilot-induced oscillation up to that boom. I always like the boomer to put the thing stabilized, and I would fly my receptacle right up to it, and then he can plug me in the lock hydraulically. If he tries to fly that boom, and you're coming at him, and he's moving it around, it's hard not to get into a little, sing-song with him.
Yeah.
And sometimes that would happen with Sparky. And I was afraid that in and out of these clouds, as we coasted up on this tanker, that if I send him to the wing of the tanker, I may lose him.
Yeah,
and now all this is for naught because he's going lost wing man. And I'm trying to, I'll meet you at King Cleve Military City, So we want to get to the target. This was the little bit later, first day of the ground war. Makes some stories up. But we did that. We refueled underneath a thunderstorm, and I refueled with him in close formation. I didn't send him to the wing. I said, you stay in close. When I'm done refueling, I'll slide off to the right. You get your gas, and then we'll go. And it worked perfectly.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I got my gas. I slid to the side. He got plugged the first time. Boom, off we go. We diverted to KKMC anyway. The weather was so bad that we couldn't get to the target till later.
Wow.
Interesting story about forward air controllers. In the chow line at KKMC, a couple guys back, I hear a voice that I recognize. I turn around. It's a guy named Scott Buchanan. Bucky Buchanan was a guy in my first squadron, the 23rd TAS, that didn't go to Suwon. He was flying OA-10s when the bubble burst, and he is in BDUs in the chow line with his army guys.
Oh,
ground forward air controller, not flying airplanes during the. And the next day, as the ground war, as they were invading, the fact that came up on the and authenticated me. I gave him authentication. I said, good voice on you, Bucky. It was Bucky Buchanan on the ground with his army unit. as my ground floor
air control. Awesome.
Yeah, awesome. But man, you know, here's a guy that did everything I did, and he's on the ground during the war. So
yeah,
you know, that can happen.
Luck
but
and
anyway, we so the back to the all those tanks. I got hit. So my airplane was trashed. I was going to fly it back to King Fahd that next day, which is the last day we're going to be at Elju, with one engine because they didn't have an engine to change up there. So I got Sparky's airplane, and I got a guy from the 75th Squadron at England Air Force Base. He's Lieutenant Jay Keller is my number two, not Sparky, on this fateful mission where it's going to be my last mission out of Elju. That afternoon, I'm going to fly that broken airplane home. But I got Sparky's airplane to go up one more time stud hunting with a guy from the 75th I've ever flown with. And they, you know, and you'd be surprised that different squadrons have some different tactics, briefing methods and things. And so we got through a briefing and we're going to go. It's all pretty routine for us by now. But as we go up, we are on the outskirts of an airfield out there. They had moved some fighter airplanes off the runway, off the airfield area, down a road and put them in some earthen revetments off the airfield. And there's a Su-27 set right there in revetment. So we roll in on that. Yeah, we roll in on that. And it was the airplane that wouldn't die. So we're dropping CBU on it. Bomb, it's everywhere. And it's just, there's no secondaries. It's like, does it not have fuel or oil or whatever? I mean, it's really getting silly. It's like, this thing is not going to blow up. We should just leave. It's not that big of a deal. But it's one of those things that it really got stupid. Frankly, I should have just knocked it off and moved on because it was an insignificant target. But you get to this thing where you want the thing to blow up. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
And so so I make one more pass. And as we're pulling off, Jay's a little behind me and high. And as I'm climbing, he reports that it's all of a sudden starting to smoke. And so as we move over towards where the tanks were, there's this big billow of smoke. I don't know if you see this painting right here, it's up there. This is a painting that depicts the shoot down. We're moving on towards the tank, and AWACS is calling for some A-10s that were some Cajuns that had already departed. I knew that they had departed the target area, and AWACS is giving them a low, slow contact, 270 for 20. But and so he's using their, and I saw, I come up on the radio, said, I know they've already changed off the freak. And I said, whatever their call sign was, has RTB, what do you got? We're close. And he says, low, slow contact, 270 for 20. I'm thinking he's using their position to that target, not my position. And so I say, confirm that you've got a good contact on me and that this is a vector. And he said, look 060 for two. I'm at like 20,000.
Two, it's right below. Yeah.
It's right below me. And you know, so I'm thinking low and slow. They weren't flying anything in the daytime, but I'm thinking helicopter maybe. Because now we know that maybe those radars can pick up a vehicle moving across the desert, but there's just not much moving along. We knew that there were people down there with those tanks. It's a big array of tanks. So we wondered if maybe the command element hadn't you know, retrograded maybe at that point.
They left, abandoned.
So I'm thinking all this stuff. And my Army training that helped with this, I'm thinking all this stuff, like maybe the helicopters come in to take some of the commanders out of this place as we're continuing to decimate their forces there. And so get a little excited with the air contact, right? And so I'm looking, you know, there's no radar. I'm looking for the same. I'm cooling down my A9 mics, and we had the good all aspect heat seekers and two of them, and I'm cooling those things down. I'm looking for this thing, and so there I see a little smoke, a little dust, just it's right down on the ground, and it's moving like helicopter speed, and it's flying. It's a helicopter. It's like a medium, like transport helicopter, like an Mi-8, for instance. And it's got the little, like an Iron Eagle, it's got the little rocket wings off the side. Man, it's a helicopter. So it's like a truck moving across the desert to an A-10. I roll in with the A-9s, and it just won't lock on. It just will the desert was hotter than the exhaust of the helicopter.
Yeah, it just wouldn't
move through. I get the kind of, I'd hear the tone and it just would bounce off. Like, man, it's like watching those Vietnam movies. And so, so I'm thinking, oh, just use the gun, right? So so you just lead the thing a little bit. You know, we had no lead computing gun sight or anything that we came back then. But so you just lead a little bit, like a truck moving fast, and hammer away. And so, but man, I'm getting a little low. So again, bang through the floor. You think I learned that lesson? But you get like that. You want to kill that target even more than the stupid Su-27. You want this thing. You don't think about it's a big deal, an air-to-air kill with a gun. It's just an unusual target and probably has high-value assets in it, but they wouldn't be flying in the daytime. They're not bringing somebody lunch or whatever, you know, at that time. And so you want to hammer this thing, but it's not getting away from me. Now it's, you know, it's going towards Baghdad. We're a fair piece from there. I can chase it down, you know, even in the daytime. So I'm getting fairly low. And the in this little town of New Tibe, there is there's 23 millimeter. There's several there's three batteries of 23 millimeter. There's ZSU 23 cores. So four barrels, 100 rounds per second from each barrel, and there's 12 of them. You know? So they're hosing the thing with the little platform below me. And now it's like not so much below me as all around me. And so I'm jinking for all it's worth. And you don't have a lot of energy at that point. Jinking in that kind of heat in an A-10 loaded like that, it's slow climb away from the guns. And so I'm thinking, wow, I did not need to get that low. I was about 5,000 feet. Not need to get that low. So I extended a little bit, but you just whip her bill right back in. So back in I go. And I aimed a little bit better, hammered away again. And the first, it was smoking a little bit for that second pass. And it blew up real good for that, wow. that second pass. And and it was pretty exciting. And then jink away again, totally out of breath. You want to say something like cool, like, you know, give me a vector. I'm coming home. Bogey's now or whatever. And I said, well, it was. It's burning now.
That is cool.
It wasn't cool at all. You know, I breathe like this, you know, just pulling the G's and all that, and extending and thinking that I didn't need to get that low, but I'm okay, I think. And then you realize it, shot down the helicopter. And so now everybody in the world wants to talk to you. You're not sure what you can say on the radio. You know, they want to know what the type is. King Star, the AWACS, the general officer of AWACS is very concerned that I didn't shoot down a friendly. Because that had, you know, that had been a little bit of pressure stuff. And so I knew I hadn't, but there's sort of thought that goes through. And I VID'd that thing. I know it's good. And got back and debriefed and intel guys, and there was a little hoorah. But then we had to go. I had to fly an airplane with one motor back to King Fog, and so off you go. And about halfway there, ELT goes off. And somebody's jumped out of an airplane, and another one. And that's the day we lost Steve Phillips and Rob Sweet to A-10 guys. Sif was a weapons officer, super, super great, super experienced guy. His wingman, Rob Sweet, got hit, SA-9, I think twice. And Steve didn't see a shoot. Started setting up a SAR, and Steve got hit by the same missile battery. And turns out Sweet got about one swing in the shoot, and Sif never made it out of jet. And but we thought they were both gone. We had a memorial service for Sweet and Sif. Their families were informed. And then 5 weeks later, and the POWs are getting on the Red Cross bus, their Sweet man. His dad. Isn't that Rob Sweet? He's got a stereo, but he's alive, you know, and we didn't know. And so, I've written an article about this shoot down, and I call it Thunderbolt Triumph and Tragedy, because it was a pretty good day for the A-10s. In fact, the citation for my DFC reads that on that day, I accounted for all of enemy aircraft losses. Kills a kill, mover. And
counted.
So it was neat, and got back to FOD, and again, the excitement of that was very short lived when we heard that it was, you know, two A-10s that we'd lost up north. So and when that ELT goes off, you want to go But I got one motor in here. I got to get that.
It's harder. It's harder with one.
The cool thing is, it was a Friday night back at RAF Falconbury, with the time difference. The squadron that did not go to the war, the 509th, and their significant other, and the 511 spouses were at the club.
And
the DO, the wing DO, is back at Falconbury, pulls my wife out of the crowd. And says, "I want to let you know something real exciting happened today. That's okay, you know." But he shot down the helicopter. What'd she do, mover? She went in and rang the bell and bought the bar.
Nice.
Oh, shit. All right.
Good honor.
So it was cool. And so it was neat. Not a significant target in the big scheme of things, but I think it may be still the last air-to-air gun kill in the history of air combat. I say that, I still pay full price for coffee and stuff, but it's cool. That jet is forever, you know, tied to that event. And I think there's been arrangements that when it's retired, whatever, 2089 or something, it's going to come here to Oklahoma City to the airspace, to the Science Museum of Oklahoma.
Oh, that's awesome.
And be on the display here. So, yeah.
Nice.
So that's kind of neat. But it's an A-10C now. I mean, what?
It's all upgraded. You wouldn't even recognize it.
I don't even know what it is. The thing is. But it's cool. And it opened up some neat things afterwards, like Air Vice Marshal Johnny Johnson and Laddie Lucas wrote books together. They're both passed on now. And the last book they wrote was called Great Air Battles from the Somme, World War One, to Desert Storm. And they, I got a call back in England now, came back in July. And I got a call from the Wing Commander Secretary, said, the Knights, because they're both Knights of the British, you know, Knights of the British.
Nice.
Order of British Empires and OBE. The Knights are requesting your presence at lunch tomorrow at the Officers Club. So I said, I probably wear like a blue suit, right? And she said, oh, they knew you'd say that. And Air Vice Marshal Johnson says, if you wear anything other than a flight suit, they're going to strip you naked, make you wear the length of the flight line. So I show up in a green bag, and they're, of course, dressed to the nines in suits and stuff.
Yeah.
And we have lunch, and they tell me that they're writing their last book together, and they're gonna put me in their book. Awesome. That was really cool. It wasn't a great air battle, really, in the big scheme of things, but it was kind of neat, and it was neat for those guys to put me in their book and all the other books and things that came along. But this painting right here is the last story. Painting's really neat. This is Jeff Pleasance, who's a pretty famous British aviation
that is awesome
artist. And my wife, again, she commissioned him to paint this of the shoot down. So he looked at my, I sent him some, he sent me some sketches that he came to the base. He looked at my gun camera film and VTR tape. And then he came back with the final sketches and wanted a down payment, half the price, $7,500. And so I called the engineer up and said, the captains did okay, but we didn't make that kind of money. And I said, hey, you're talking about the price of this thing, right? She said, I don't really remember. I mean, I'm sure I did. Yeah, it's about $15,000. He wants half today. She's like, I mean, we could afford that, but it should be. It's a lot of money. I mean, it's a neat idea. But I said, so we said we would not. And I said, well, you get to call him. offer him something for his work he's done now. And he very graciously said, no, don't worry about that. He called her back about 20 minutes later and said, do you think the captain would sign 250 prints for me? She said, I don't see why not. So I spent 3 days at the O Club a few months later with, you know, hand all pimp.
Because I wrote up.
250 little things. I wrote Todd Shanghai Shia, sign that, 511 PFS, Operation Desert Storm, 15 February 91, MIA hip.
Oh, you got to be sick of doing that.
150 times. But after that was done, he said, can you get your wife back over here? Sure. And he presented her with this for nothing. So that's the awesome. List. He painted every stroke of that, and it's pretty cool. There's some prints out there somewhere, but I stuck it down here in the wall office for this today. So
that is awesome.
It was neat. The A-10 was awesome. I stayed in the A-10. I had the opportunity to go fly the F-117 after the war, and I wanted to stay in the A-10. And another opportunity to fly F-16, stay in the A-10. After Falconbury, I did draw that squadron down. I think one of the pictures I sent you was me with some champagne. That was my Finney flight. my PCS from Elkinberry to Pope Air Force Base, North Carolina, was in an A-10. I flew it from Elkinberry to the Azores to Myrtle Beach to the Boneyard. And that Finney flight was me and Champagne and that airplane going into the Boneyard. And then I went to Pope to be part of the first composite wing ever in the Air Force. F-16s, A-10s, and C-130s, a brigadier general as wow. a wing team, who had only flown C-5s and was like 4 years below to everything. Great guy, General Bobby Floyd. I was his CNI captain, instructor pilot. He shows up having flown C-5s. His whole career was such as it was, 13, 14 years to brigadier. And Air Command and Staff College or somewhere. And he had like, no kidding, like 6 hours in the A-10 at the schoolyard. And there he is. And I'm climbing the ladder to help him start the thing, and fly and chase everywhere. But he did all right. But that got me to weapons school. So I was cool. Jumped past, I was the youngest guy to ever go. Yeah, cool. There's a story there too. That is cool. But
what's the story?
Well, the story is they don't let guys go that young anymore. I kind of bounced over a couple of people to go. First of all, I was the first guy ever to have combat since Vietnam to go to weapons school. The instructors wow. that were there, a couple of them had rotated over. They took the quick instructor. By the way, when you're an Air Force and Navy guy, so you know this, but for the Navy types out there, the Top Gun that was depicted in that movie. Is the second one even out yet? The second?
Moving back.
You haven't gotten to ruin that one first yet, right?
Yeah, no. They keep moving it because they're afraid.
Yeah. Well, anyway, back to Top Gun school, most of their fleet instructor class, I think, go to that, right? It's 6 weeks long. It's a great course, super cool. Made a big difference in Vietnam, obviously. But the Air Force's Top Gun, the fighter weapons instructor course, is 6 months long.
Yeah.
And most instructor classes do not go to that. And so it's a big deal. And normally there's a big spin-up program, like the guy that's been there before gives you all the gouge, and you do a lot of the type of sorties and missions that you're going to do out of weapons school. And so I'm the youngest guy ever, fresh out of combat for the most part, the first guy to have combat, except a couple of instructors had rotated over for a few combat missions. So Shanghai's got a pretty big target on me. And I'm the OA-10 guy. I'm the guy, the first ever dual qualified instructor pilot in A-10s and OA-10s.
Wow.
So my OA-10 stuff served me well, not only to sort of accelerate my career to that F-16, then to Elkinberry, but then to combat. It just, just the things that happen that you can't really predict or control, but you can influence maybe by just putting your notes down and working hard, doing your best, and it will work out. And so there I'm at weapons school, but I had no spin up, and I hadn't done a lot of these tactics that the A-10 guys had done back in the day in Europe, and so a little disadvantage there, but worked really hard. We're just outside of Las Vegas, Dallas, right? For 6 months, I remember going downtown one night in that whole time. God. We just studied. We had debriefs that would start on a Friday after the morning go, and then you'd adjourn to go to the club. And then on Saturday, you'd come back and debrief some more, and maybe Sunday a little bit. Just for one flight. It's just brutal. My squadron came out for red flag. The course was about three quarters over. I'd already sewn up the academic award, and it was looking good to, maybe for a shot at the Robbie Reisner trophy, which is the top guy. And our weapons officer from the 511th that went to combat with us, John Carter, was a Reisner trophy winner. And really my mentor and kind of hero in A-10s. So I got big shoes to fill. I'm doing well, working super hard. It was very, very difficult. My squadron comes out, boss takes me to dinner and tells me that when I finish, I'm going to squadron officer school in residence. And then I'm going to be general's aide. And then I'm going to be doing a tour at the Pentagon and plum assignment. I'll be major below the zone, probably 2 years. Come back, go to squadron officer school, be the general's aide for probably 18 months, and then off you go. And I punched out. Not roughly, but I just, I actually SIE'd from weapons school. And so, only way I could do it. I just said, you know, and here's the thing. Nobody ever went to weapons school that young before. So everybody was on their second commitment. You know, yeah, I had 6 years after pilot training. I think it's maybe 8 or maybe 10 now. It's
10 now, yeah.
So I had not finished my 6 years after pilot training.
Yet. Wow.
So I was close. It was just a few months off. But there I am, about, you know, really literally like 5-6 weeks from graduating from weapons school. And I didn't want that career, frankly. I mean, I had done all the great flying I was going to do. And it's not just about flying. The Air Force is about a lot of other things. If you go to weapons school, they're kind of grooming you. They think you have some potential for maybe some command positions. And I was proud of that. I was actually, this is interesting too. My squadron commander from the 511th Combat Squadron was the United States Air Forces in Europe Field Grade Officer of the Year for 1991. And I was the United States Air Force in Europe Company Grade Officer of the Year for 1991. And so, and did a lot of neat things as a spokesman up for the A-10 in combat, and especially fast jets versus helicopters. and wrote kind of an after action report about the A-10 and a lot of things like that that moved me along. But that was not the mission that I wanted and thought that anybody should be doing out of weapons school. You want to go back and be the chief tactics guy and teach the young guys and teach the instructor pods. And get everybody, you know, everybody super tactical and motivated. That's what you want to be as a weapons officer, not to wear a blue suit and carrying the general. As great a guy as he was, you want to be driving his car and carrying his briefcase. The only time you'd fly would be with him, and you'd be in chase, you know, trying to keep him from killing himself. And so, you know, you can't give the Air Force ultimatum. You can make them tell you no, but if they want to tell you no, they will.
They will.
Yeah. And, so the old hero Shanghai was like at the, you know, base psychiatrist. No kidding, they thought I, you know, had some PTSD or something because nobody is like this close to
graduating. Nobody turns us down.
And maybe like going to be the top graduate of the whole year for every weapon system, and you what? You don't want to fly tomorrow? What? And you know, how do you tell them? Well, yeah, all this great stuff that they've set up for me, I don't want to do that. I think we ought to be able to fly, man. And I guess now you can. We were advocates, we were the early guys of saying, why not just let us be lieutenant colonels, squadron commander or whatever, we'll work at the wing, but we just want to stay in the cockpit for 20 years, because that's what we do. Yeah. You don't want me at squadron officer school, residence, what the hell? I need to be flying, teaching tactics to these guys. I'm the guy that does that. And so, and then there was this thing, the bonus system. I think it's like $1 million or something, isn't it? The bonus for pilots now is like way out, it's like $900,000. Back then it was like $15,000 a year for like, if you'd stay through year 12 or something, maybe it was 15, but they pay that in cash up front. Now, money's not a thing really mostly with firefighters. We make good wage, we live well, we have most of the stuff we need just there. We have our friends built in, you know, we drove nice cars and lived in nice houses and had fine women, right? And money left over for whiskey. But all of a sudden you got these guys driving, you know, brand new cars on base, and they're the bonus babies, and the guys are just a little senior to them, they're not eligible for the bonus. They've already signed up. And so all of a sudden you had the haves and the have nots, and you had the guys who were maybe the best guys getting shit assignments because they're indentured servants.
Yeah,
we got them, but yeah, these other guys are trying to entice for this bonus. We're trying to entice them to stay, so we'll give them the bonus and the better assignments. Oh, and by the way, if you're going to make major, you got to have a master's degree. So everybody's doing Embry Ridiculous online. I'm thinking, man, I'm going to do Embry Ridiculous and go to squadron officer school and drive a general's car. I should be flying airplanes. This is not, and no offense to me, but Bill Clinton's president now, social reengineering, homosexuals in the military, women in combat, all those things that maybe they're working out, whatever, but God bless. But wasn't my Air Force. Mm-hmm. And I was not disgruntled or disillusioned. I just made a decision. I had done all the great flying I was going to do. It was awesome. Super awesome experience. Wouldn't trade it.
Wow.
And we wanted to start a family. I was a preacher's kid growing up. We moved a lot. We didn't want that kind of the ops tempo was crazy too. And all of a sudden we can't fight two wars anymore. We for sure couldn't even do Desert Storm again at that point. We're drawn down. We're playing the boneyard, man. Half the A-10s are gone. Half of everything's gone. And I'm thinking, I've done my thing. And I'm talented. I'll go do business or something. And this has been an awesome experience. And it was. But you're kind of a dirtbag immediately when you. My Finney flight was the day before in the weapons school flight.
Wow.
So I'm.
That takes guts. That's a lot of fortitude.
There was a lot of second guessing it, of course. And so probably out around Nellis. My name's still not the best, probably. Pete Mitchell. But there's a new rule. I think they call it the Shanghai rule. You can't go to weapons school until after that first commitment is. The second commitment is signed up. Because you sign a document before weapons school that says you will give them 4 years.
Yeah.
Graduate.
Wow. So what did you do after?
What's that? Oh, afterwards, came back to Oklahoma City because my parents were here. We moved here when I was a senior in high school. My dad took a church here and went to college here. And so moved back here. Her parents were from here. And we had a lot of contacts. A college professor of mine that taught real estate and economics had a real estate brokerage. There had been a oil bust here, but real estate was just rebounding, and he was rebuilding his brokerage, and he recruited me to learn the residential real estate business and run that for him. But after 2 years, I got a broker's license of my own. I opened my own brokerage, specialized in new homes for 15 years, got an MBA, a real one, not every ridiculous, a real MBA. And I actually teach entrepreneurship to master students now at college. I was president of the Chamber of Commerce in Northwest Oklahoma City for a couple of years, grew it by about threefold.
The
governor declared a day in my honor and such. And so I did a lot in business and ended up VP of sales and marketing for the largest private home builder in California.
Okay.
Being the only person in Oklahoma ever to get all the sales and marketing designations in from the National Association of Home Builders. I did that. Ran for the legislature once as well.
Oh, really?
The 16-year incumbent by 184 votes is a great experience. But
yeah, wow.
But we had two children as well, I went to California. We moved to California and did that big job with this huge builder about 18 months before the real estate mortgage market crashed. Crashed, this was a 50-year-old family company, built 900 homes a year, and in the next 9 months it was just gone. I wanted to go see what a big builder was like. I had a company here that did sales marketing in Oklahoma City. We didn't have big national builders, so I had seven builders who were my clients, president of the Home Builder Association, etc. They all built about 20 homes a year, and we did all their sales and marketing, model homes and sales centers and such.
Wow.
There's like herding cats with all these different builders and their design. And so I wanted to see what it was like to work for a big builder with one team and one mission and one product. And I did, and it was awesome. It was kind of like combat. It was all encompassing. That's all I wanted. But then when it crashed hard, and this company is just gone. And so my father, after the ministry, had gotten the hearing aid business and had a pretty successful hearing aid clinic. And so even before I'd gone to California, kind of what if would I be interested in that? But so when the market crashed out there, I flew home and said, "Dad, I'm thinking about that real that hearing aid business."
About that idea, yeah, I'm interested.
So I worked with him for 6-7 years, and he passed away last year.
Yeah, I'm sorry to hear that.
I've been on the board of directors for this with Folks of Honor, which I think is awesome that you're involved with that. Phoenix Recovery Institute is the transitional living facility for homeless veterans in Oklahoma City. We have about 20 beds for emergency and 16 for it's called grant per diem to take veterans from homelessness to independent living and gainful employment again. And right by the VA Medical Center, big old house here. So I've been on the board of directors about 3 years. And during COVID, they asked me to be resident manager. We locked the guys down for 45 days.
Wow.
Back a year ago when there's 60 cases in the state and we had the streets were barren. and the businesses were closed. We locked the guys down, and our resident manager became ill like day two, and has COPD anyway, and so he was quarantined, and so we needed somebody to move into the house. You know, me being a bachelor, and I was doing hearing tests at that point for the Veterans Foundation, Dale Graham Veterans Foundation. So they would send me the people to do the hearing tests and write up the disability nexus letter for tinnitus or hearing loss from their perspective. So I was doing that. It turns out my office was just down the street from Phoenix, what we call Phoenix House, where we house the veterans. And so being on their board and being down the street, I just moved in here. That was about a year ago. I'm still here. I'm in the office at Phoenix House right now, but it's a really awesome place. 97-year-old house in a historic area of Oklahoma City. The state capitol is about two blocks from us, and the VA Medical Center and OU Medical Center are two blocks the other way. And but it's a facility that obviously 100 years takes its toll. I just wrote a $98,000 grant, community development block grant, that the city is, tomorrow they will take a look at, and I think it will be approved in March, to upgrade some
of
the infrastructure at the facility. Phoenix Recovery Institute, or Phoenix House, on your Facebook page, I'll make a picture.
Really
great place. We've got veterans that from all ages and all services, and combat or not combat, or served back in way back when for a couple of years, and somehow found themselves homeless. And it's neat to see guys get their camaraderie back, their drive back, to remember that they served in the military. They served honorably, and whatever they fell into, they can overcome again.
That's
some great success stories of guys. Some guys come out of prison and things that come here, it's a neat thing. It's a grind as well, of course, but it's a worthy grind. I had the time, and so I've been enjoying doing that. So
I did
own a couple airplanes. After the Air Force, a Piper Cherokee and a Piper Comanche, and so I enjoyed flying those around and leased them to the college that rent them to students that did the aviation business program that I helped them with as well. So, but the President University had a Beechcraft V-35, and I got to fly a Lear 25 that the wealthy guy here in town owns, flew a Pilatus PC-12 one a couple times too, just around. So I kept my hand in aviation a little bit. I probably will again, something with a couple of guys in a light twin or something like that.
That'd be good.
Got some neat general aviation stories as well, but aviation has been very, very good to me.
You didn't mention, is it a play off your last name, or do you have a story behind your call sign?
Well, as probably in the Air Force, a lot of times there's some guy in the squadron who's the clever guy that gives call signs, and a lot of times somebody screws up. We had crash and skid and that kind of stuff. And sometimes it's sort of a secret, and sometimes I'm making sense at all. Well, I had just volunteered to go to Korea from my first squadron, 23rd task. And when your name is Sheehy, it can be Sheehy or Sheehy. The Irish pronunciation would be Sheehy. But in southern Missouri, where my father's family immigrated from Ireland to New York, to Michigan, to southern Missouri, back to Michigan. And down there, they tend to put a draw on kind of the end of word. And so she kind of drew it out. And so there it is. And it is pronounced that way sometimes, that Y can be a silent or an I. And so people mess up that name all the time. And so you're correcting them. It's Sheehy, not Sheehy. And so the clever guy in the 23rd task, and I just volunteered to go to Korea, said, "You're going to Korea, huh? Shanghai. I know Shanghai is not in Korea. Close enough.
Good enough for government work.
Yeah, that's a nice concept. So, what a great time to fly. Great time to fly the A-10. It's the golden days of the A-10. It's still a great airplane, and it's still a great mission. And all that crazy gee whiz stuff they got is cool. But at the end of the day, they all know how to get a grease pencil out and talk to a guy on the ground and see the bad guys and see the good guys, troops in contact, close air support. That's what the A-10 does.
Hell yeah.
One other quick little thing. One day I'm sitting in I'm getting, I just hopped hitter fuel. I'm getting an intel briefing for the next mission. And here comes some SUVs, and then out pops both colonels, and then some guy that's like a CIA guy with the MAC-10s under his vest, and Secretary of Defense is getting out of the car right there. And
wow.
And so he walks right up to my airplane, and he says, "Captain, you have a grease pencil?" "Yes, Mr. Secretary, I do. Can I borrow it?" "Certainly, sir." So there I go, handing the grease pencil, and he signs my Maverick missile to Saddam, Dick Cheney, U.S. Secretary of Defense.
That is awesome.
"Mr. Grease Pencil, Captain, would you mind taking that up to my friend Saddam for me?" "I'd be honored to, Mr. Secretary." So there you go.
It also happened to be
The Maverick that I had stuck a zap on that said NASA. My brother happens to be now the chief scientific advisor to the mission space director at NASA.
Holy crap.
Yeah, he's that guy. theoretical chemistry and theoretical physics, PhD. And so he's the top, I think they call him chief engineer now, but he's the top science guru at NASA. And
wow.
So he was working at the Ames Research Center there at that time, and he sent me some zaps. And so I put one on a Maverick, said, "Fly NASA." And that's the one that Secretary Cheney signed. And it became a poster, apparently, as I took a picture of it, sent to my brother, became a poster that was like in every cubicle in NASA for a long time.
That is awesome.
That was pretty cool when the Secretary of Defense comes up and signs a missile.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was an A-10 war, man. We crushed.
That is awesome.
We flew 42 days, 144 A-10s, over 8,500 missions.
Damn.
And I counted, the BDA indicates we counted for about a third of all of the enemy equipment loss, tanks, armored personnel carriers, that kind of thing. And in 42 days, air power, the ground guys did great. They had some tank battles with the Republican guys too. Wasn't all walking the park and round up prisoners. But 42 days, air power decimated.
Yeah.
Fourth largest army in the world, dug in with tons of high speed stuff.
That's badass. And,
took apart their command and control. No comm. No supply. No command and control. Just blind. Rico Rodriguez. He had a couple of good. He had an ACM engagement with those MiGs a couple of times, but those guys didn't know what they're doing. Without GCI, and he did.
Wow.
Those guys, I was on the ground. The neat thing about a fire squadron, too, in the Air Force is you got an Army guy that's with you. The ground liaison officer, our guy was cool. And the day after the ceasefire, he took us up in a convoy of Hummers up onto the battlefield. So I actually have a great picture of me and Sparky shaking hands right at the edge of the pier where that surface air missile shot at me my first mission.
Correct.
But we saw that battlefield, that highway of death, as they called it, and all those vehicles and burned out and horrible. But we saw the squalor, the troop trenches that those soldiers were in for those days where they were being bombarded with no resupply and not much hope. And it was horrible. But Kuwait free, and they torched every oil well, 500 something of them. That was a sight to see, but it was an unprecedented effort, a big coalition, tremendous use of air power, lessons learned from Vietnam, applied appropriately to the next thing. The next conflict will be different. Iraq the second time was different. Afghanistan is different. The next thing, who knows? We have seen the last manned fighter built, huh?
No. No, well, I mean, the 6th gen is going to be manned, so.
It will.
Yeah.
Wait, that's 22 something, isn't it? No, Fat Amy. Yeah, whatever.
Fat Amy's manned, I guess. I mean, it's, it's a bummer. What advice, I know we're wrapping up, but what advice would you have for somebody wanting to be a fighter pilot these days, just based off of your life and your experience?
Yeah, you know, I got an opportunity a lot of times to talk to schools and stuff, you know, kids at school and things and talk about the A-10 and and I actually had a, back, this was back in the day of the, I had a slide projector. Slides in it. Next slide.
Slide.
Yep. And you get that question, you know, I'm going to be a firefighter. You know, what I would say is, I'd say study science and study math and study hard, be physically fit, be a good citizen, you know, do all those things, apply for stuff that you're interested in, and let the chips fall where they may. Things are going, I believe things will be what they're going to be. And you can't change the outcome of your life, but you can change how you react to things that happen in your life. And you can just do your very best, and the opportunities that are meant for you will be there. I just don't think you can realistically say, I want to be a fighter pilot, and go be a fighter pilot. Can you point yourself in that direction? Can you do what you did and just be doggedly, you know, just affirmative that you're not going to take no? Of course. And that's your advice there is awesome. Make them tell you no. Ask for the waivers. Leave no stone unturned, but realize that it's a crazy lofty goal, and you really don't even know when you're 15, 16, whatever, what qualifications will be necessary. I happen to be just the right, you know, height and color, you know, no color blindness, and the right eyesight and right dexterity and the right attitude and the right temperament and the right grades and the right community service to get into that matrix and be deemed, you know, worthy to be a candidate. But then you go be a candidate at a commissioning source, whether it's ROTC, in your experience where they said, I won't be a pilot. Well, look at you. You're like the king. You're an awesome pilot in two different services, in two different airplanes. You're like the Renaissance man. They didn't think you would make it, right? I mean, you really are. I don't know where, how you find the time. I think you're an alien. Crazy.
an alien. We already determined I'm a princess. I can't be a princess and an alien. I mean, come on.
Princess Alien. So your next book right there.
Yeah. The Princess Alien. The Princess Copyright Alien. 2021, Shanghai.
I get a little bit of something like that. A little big on it. So, but look at you, you know. And so it's, I just think the advice is just do everything to the best of your ability. Have that goal. You gotta have goals, but have some other goals too, because it just really is a thing that, I mean, I don't want to discourage anybody by any means.
No, have but a backup plan.
You're gonna have most people pretty disappointed. And then people say, well, I want to go fly a fighter. And in the fighter community, we kind of get the fighter pilots and the other pilots, right? But you know, I saw a thing on YouTube just the other night. C-17 doing a max descent, tactical descent, 20,000 to 5,000 feet in a minute, 35 degrees with the thrust reversers out. That's pretty cool stuff.
Yeah.
You know, it's not an A-10, but it's cool. And, you know, too many people in there, but it's cool. And they, so anything you're flying is awesome. And you never know what the next thing will lead to. And again, the spear is very sharp, and that point is very small, and that point is the fighter pilots. We brag about it, sure, but all the other stuff that's required to support that effort is phenomenal and very important. You know, in Desert Storm, the in-service rates of the airplane, the mission capable rates of the A-10 were better in combat than in any surge we ever had, in any ORI ever. The loss rate, mover, who would have ever, I mean, you would be going to see the psychiatrist as a crazy guy if you said we were going to have a war with the fourth largest army in the world in a dug-in, you know, desert environment, and we're going to send 500,000 troops over there, we're going to have, you know, I mean, airplanes and fly bazillions of sorties, and we're going to lose 0.00005, you know, 8,500 missions, we lost 6 A-10s, we lost 2 guys, it's horrible. But in Vietnam,
oh yeah, yeah, you know, it was every mission.
I mean, anything, any conflict ever, that those loss rates were so small, and it wasn't that they were pansies. They fought hard. We're just that much better. Yeah. Our stuff's better. Our training, our tactics, our pilots, but all of the support stuff too. I don't go up there and drop bombs if they don't get loaded. You know, so we had CBUs that hadn't been serviced since like Vietnam. They actually had to like cut all the primer cords out and like redo them so that the canisters would open. I mean, that kind of stuff. But I mean, just the effort to get that stuff there, to get the troops there, to refuel us in thunderstorms, you know, stuff like that. It's just mind-boggling.
Wow.
Yeah, player pilots get to be interviewed on your thing. But you know, all the other stuff that happens is so important, mission critical. And I know in my squadron and at King Fahd International Airport, everybody felt like they were contributing to that tremendous victory, and they were. We couldn't have done it without that. And I think the loss rates being low, the thing being fairly short, the ground war being relatively quick, 100 hours, was a tribute to all of that happening.
Yeah.
And Air Force was awesome then. It's awesome now. I don't know what Space Force is or whatever, but I like their thing, Defenders of Space. Guardians.
They're the Guardians.
Guardians of Space.
Well, Shanghai, it has been an absolute honor to hear your story. Thank you so much for coming on the channel. I appreciate it.
Great to talk to you. Enjoyed it.
It has been amazing. Thanks so much. Any parting shots for the audience, kids at home? They're still watching. Pretty good crowd tonight. So
#attack. #attack. We're attack pilots. A-10 guys, attack pilots.
There you go. Well, awesome. Thanks so much for being on the channel. I'll put the links in the description if you'll send me to your foundation and everything for your charity. Send me that. We'll make sure we get those links out and we'll support that. But thank you so much.
Donation of yours tomorrow. Folds of Honor is a cool thing.
Yes, absolutely. Support Folds of Honor too. Thanks, Shanghai. We appreciate you having on the channel. Thank you, everyone. Have a good night. We'll see you on the next one.
Take care.